Let's send it!
Pastrana goes round, contact in the background.
Larson shocked the world.
Absolutely unstoppable.
Skoll, welcome to the land of Vikings.
Absolutely brilliant. He gets the win. The Backerud blue. Now we're talking.
We will not go out without a fight. We will prevail.
Disaster.
Pastrana jumps super long, takes the lead immediately.
Travis Pastrana gets the win.
That's right, Glenn, hell and back. It's Halloween weekend.
It's going to be a first ever Nitro Rallycross victory for Fraser McConnell. Look at that.
Round five, under the lights in Arizona.
Gets it. The checkered flag is Travis Pastrana,
the first double winner this year. Backward rolls, enormous crash, end over end. Larson going to jump into the sunset here in Phoenix.
Pumping the roof. He's excited.
Hello and welcome. Bonjour. We are here at Trois-Rivieres. I'm Jared Deanna. Joining me once again, Andrew Coley. We're in the Great White North. We're on frozen ice. We got spikes on our shoes, man.
We need them, mate. This is so slippery. You cannot stand on this. This is the banked turn one. We're going to see 5, 6, 7, even 8 FC1Xs coming around here. Is anyone going to dare to take that high line? They could be put in the snowy wall. I just can't wait to go racing here. We really don't know what to expect. We've never seen rallycross at this level on this surface. We've even made a special tyre for it. I can't wait.
That's what I was going to say. We have spikes on, but so do the cars, right? They're studded Yokohama tyres. We're making history. First time ever, FC1X, all electric. Here at Trois-Rivieres. Four rounds are left. What's at stake? What do drivers need to do? Who's in the hunt?
There's five drivers at the top of the table who can still theoretically take the title. You're looking at Robin Larson, Andreas Backerud from the RX Cartel. You've got Fraser McConnell and Ollie Ericsson. And then you've got Travis Pastrana, last year's champion, as a little bit of an outside hope. He's really got to send it. He has to win if he wants to take this title. I think Larson's going to take the slightly more measured approach, but whoever is going to win this title is going to have to do well on snow and ice, because this round and the next one are on this surface.
That's right. You got a beanie on, gloves on? Come on, you're built for this, man. I'm from California and I got less on. Guess what? I'm super excited. We're talking about cool runnings. Fraser McConnell, he's from Jamaica. Feel the rhythm, feel the ride. Come on now, it's racing time. Let's send it.
So this is how the gnarliest motorsport on the planet works. Group E is the top dog all-electric formula, full of superstar drivers like these guys. Day one is qualifying. There are head-to-head knockout battle brackets between two drivers until we reach the final. The further you get, the better you start on day two. And the guy who wins the battle bracket final gets to lift the trophy. And they also get a little sticker, which they get to put on the side of the car, Fighter Ace Top Gun style. Anyway, day two sees full grids. The aim is to reach the final. First up, it's the heats where the winners go through. Next chance is the semis where the top two go straight through to the final. And if you still haven't found your mojo, you get one more chance in the LCQ, the last chance qualifier, where the top two go through to the final. Of course, the first across the line to see the checkered flag is the winner of the event. And the guy at the end of the year with the most points is your Nitro Rallycross Global Champion. If you didn't get any of that because you're looking at your phone, don't worry. Coley and I will be your tour guides for the season. All you really need to know is Nitro Rallycross is gnarly.
Gnarly it is, and if you're into snow, ice, racing, the cold weather, it is going to be a perfect night here at Trois-Rivieres. I'm Kate Osborne, alongside Jared and Coley and Street Bike Tommy. We're out trackside, and guys, I am no meteorologist, but I can tell you that it is cold, and with this wind chill, it's even colder, so these drivers have a big uphill battle to fight. Now, another thing that's really interesting is that this track is 0.82 miles long. With that Joker lap, it's 0.84 miles. They know what they're up against. That track condition is 100% snow and ice. And some of the conversations that are happening are the studs in these tires, how there's going to be grip or how there's not going to be grip as the track turns to slush. It's going to be really interesting out there. And guys, these temps are cold, but these drivers, we know they are experienced. Some of them have been out driving in the snow a long time. Others, like Fraser McConnell, just happened to start last week. These are just a few of the ins and outs of this weekend, but let's go to Andrew Coley with Coley's Notebook for all you really need to know about Nitro Rallycross here in Trois-Rivieres.
So we're in Canada for round 7 and everything is looking a little bit different. The paddock's in this tent, your opponents are right next door. We're on studded tyres and snow and ice for the first time ever at this level of rallycross. Pastrana last time out became the first double winner. Brilliant job by him, but he's got to win everything if he wants to get into the championship fight. And over this side is the man who leads that title race, Robin Larson. 5 podiums from 6 races. But in these conditions, we can take the form book and we can tear it up.
It's going to be special on the ice. It's new for everybody, especially in this car and these tires, so I really hope we can provide a lot of action.
I honestly have no idea what to expect, but that's my forte. Send it and see what happens. I think this team at Vermont Sports Car, these guys know how to set these kind of cars up for the cold, and we're ready to rock.
I just want to do 2 clean runs here in the winter so I can go back to Glen Helen and have a comfortable final. But it's easier to say that than to do it.
We have to win everything. I think we've got a good shot at going 1-2, and we need to for the rest of this championship. We want to take home the win.
The Ericsson brothers. We've been saying all season that we expect to see them up at the top of the timesheets. Ollie Ericsson has twice been the top qualifier, but so far hasn't managed to convert that into the win. Now, they've got plenty of experience of driving on snow and ice. This man, Fraser McConnell from Jamaica, not so much. And we'll be hearing more from him over the course of the weekend. Now, on the other hand, Chris Meek has got absolutely tons of experience driving in the forest on studded tyres. But even he is saying the challenge of this is completely different.
Going on ice on these puppies, it's going to be a new experience, but something I'm excited for. I'm just so intrigued to see how these work. I'm used to a rally tyre. This looks a bit more Mad Max style, but I like it. I like the approach. Just excited. Can't wait to get out there.
So that's it. The stage is set. Everybody here together in this tent. So if anything happens out on track, it's going to be fireworks in here. What happens this weekend is really important because, of course, the next round is also on these bad boys and on snow and ice, and the championship fight is on.
There's so much that's unknown here. I think that's what the big factor is, right? And we've seen practice. We've seen them warm up. We've seen them heat up. But and admittedly, we normally have kind of seeding runs. What's unfolded? What's transpired here?
So basically, it's a bit warmer than in just the same way as sometimes we have some rain on a dirt track. It gets a bit slippery. Sometimes it's a bit dusty. Well, unfortunately, it's a little bit warmer here. Now, the temperatures have been super cold, like in Celsius. Under zero. I've learned a bit about Fahrenheit. Down in the 30s, meaning very cold, 30% hot. I've seen the Instagram thing. I liked it. It's made me understand Fahrenheit a lot more. 100% hot is 100, and anything above that's too hot. Yeah. So it's a little bit too warm, basically. And so what's happened is we want to make sure that you guys get to see a good final tomorrow. So we've adjusted things slightly. Basically, all we're doing is we're missing the battle bracket seeding races. So we go straight from timed practice into the battle bracket.
Love it.
That's it.
Simple all thrill and no filler.
Yeah, let's go.
Yeah,
let's
you're going for that TQ. You're going for that, you know, that belt. And that's, and like you said, who can convert that TQ, that top qualifying spot? Can the Ericssons do it? I mean, they have a lot of development on the ice, on the snow. You're seeing those tires, and we've talked about it. Now really comes the push, comes the shove. Also, you know, we talk about dirt being on ice. It's very comparable because, you know, you see that blue groove, and I get into that later with Ollie. I'm really excited. This is my first snow ice race in drifting and anything, so it's fun. It's cool. Oh, mate,
look, everyone's excited about this. We've never seen a top level rallycross championship take place on snow and ice. There've been some other series that have tried it. Yeah, it's a bespoke tire on a bespoke track. We like to do things in the Nitro where, you know, everything's just a little bit extra. You know, we're remembering a legend this weekend as well. We'll have more for that of you, of course, during the course of the weekend. And I just can't wait to get going, really.
Yeah, no, really exciting. So don't go anywhere. Nitro Rallycross here in Trois-Rivières, a.k.a. Three Rivers. We come back.
Here in the pits, and I know just a bit ago it was a bit cold out there. The guys are warming up. The cars get a little heat underneath them as well. The teams are, I'd say they're moderately warm in here as they're bouncing in and out. I'd like to bring note to Chris Meek. This was an interesting situation. Earlier today, that team had a gearbox issue. The entire rear of that, the engine was out, everything was out. The team was thrashing to get that car put back together with literally seconds to get Chris out on the track. The good news is they did. And actually, he's standing by right over here. Chris, You've had an interesting day, to say the least, or maybe your team has had an interesting day. The temperatures are cold. They were sweating in here trying to get the car pumped back together. From your point of view, what was the story?
The first free practice session, unfortunately, on the lap one, I heard something from the gearbox on the gear change, and the gearbox let go. So, yeah, missed all of free practice one. We got the car back here, and the guys had only like 45 minutes to change the gearbox, but in a normal competition car, that should be possible. But here, you have to take all the motors out, all the cables have to come out, subframe out. So it was a big job, and yeah, all credit my team. They done an incredible job. I did get out in the next practice session, but like you say, they were sweating a little bit.
As it relates to snow, you were comfortable in it. You've driven a lot within the snow and ice. What are the conditions like for you at this point of view?
Yeah, I knew it was going to be tricky through these time practice sessions because obviously they prepare the ice as much as they can for the first group that goes out. So the guy who's first onto the road, Robin Larson, who's leading the championship, he gets the best ice. And then because I was late arriving to the grid, I started the last of a second group. So yeah, the ice is not as good, and it's really tricky to find a level playing field. Now, once we get into these battle bracks, it's head-to-head off the start line. So yeah, it's all equal. So I think it's going to be a battle of who can get the car away off the line. It's really tricky in this condition. The cars have so much power. Even with these aggressive tyres, it can spin up. So it's going to be a challenge to see who can get away first. Whoever's in that first corner is going to for sure have the best chance of.
Interesting. Right off the line. Thank you for your time. We're going to continue on through the pits here. As you can see, Ali Bennett, his teammate, is actually out going up against Connor Martel. They are the only ones that happen to get out and drive before the quarterfinals. Meanwhile, you can see Travis Pastrana over here. That car is looking pretty good now. Earlier, it was in a bit of a different piece. Travis actually lost power steering before the jump, and he actually dislocated his thumb in free practice. Now, in talking with him after this, he's in good spirits. He says he's fine. And he's feeling like he wants to get out and race. Of course, you can see this livery. This is a tribute to honor Ken Block with that hashtag KB Forever. This was Ken Block's livery when he started with Subaru way back when in 2005. A real true honor as Travis Pastrana has stepped up to be the one to run that livery. We'll see how Travis continues to do here later on in the weekend. Hopefully his thumb being in one good place. Andreas Backerud, on the other hand, you got a smile.
Yeah.
That's
nice.
Yeah. Okay, these conditions, you are from this land of snow and ice and wind and cold. So this is nothing new.
Yeah, but I mean, like, if you come over here, like, seeing that the 12 millimeter stud, 325 studs in a tire.
Let's go take a look at those.
I mean, it's crazy. You go here with these steel brushes and clean them off and like trying to search for some traction.
I think it looks like bling.
It is bling, you know? No, it's very different from what we're used to. Back home in Norway, Sweden, we're driving on the lakes, frozen lakes. We have loads of mileage, but never anything like this. I mean, like, it really fits the car, which, like, we have so much horsepower and so much torque. So we need a study tire, but I've never seen anything like it. And it grips.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
Does it grip at all times on the track, or is it when it's just ice?
No, when it's just ice. When you get in the fluffy stuff, you lost it. You know, I was in the time practice, I was like equal with Robin on the time. Last corner, I just like went 1 meter wide, ended up in a slush, didn't get any traction, lost 2 seconds, like boom. Yeah.
Well, that's racing. And we know that. Thank you for your time. We'll be back with you here in a little bit. And as we continue to continue down the paddock, Coley, Jared, the conversations around here, it's a lot of fun. There's a lot of smiles, which is extremely important. But, of course, they haven't raced yet. They haven't gone down head to head. And that's when we know those smiles, you know, turn into maybe a little bit of a serious.
Turn that smile upside down.
You got to frown. That's right.
So, but
you're totally right, because the unknown, that, you know, everybody's kind of like, all right, nobody's lost, nobody's won just yet. But I think the fans are going to win. What do you think, Coley?
Oh, I think it's going to be. I think we're all going to win. It's going to be awesome. Well, only one person's going to win, but it's going to be awesome. The drivers have all been smiling, like Katie said, just so much. Like yesterday, they came off their first run. That's the best thing I've ever done.
Yeah.
So, well, you know, that remains to be seen if for the rest of the weekend, but yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thank Thank you so much,
well,
Katie.
I hope we all win. Yeah, yeah, for sure. Thank you, guys. We'll
stay
be,
warm.
We'll be chatting soon.
Stay
thank
warm.
You.
You're out there. We got our jackets on, but we're in a tent. She's out there kind of braving the conditions. But, you know, some of my friends and even the track workers here said, hey, I got this memory from 8 years ago that says – it was minus 35 Celsius. It was minus 35 Celsius, which is insane. So as still hearing a little bit of Katie's banter over there, and she's, you know, perusing the pits, it's great insight, you know. And we talked about, you know, conditions, what's going on. We talk about this track, you know. It's very similar to dirt. I mean, all the courses we've seen, you know, from Sweden to Norway to, I mean, just, excuse me, we didn't go to Norway, but from UK at Lydon, the conditions change.
Yeah, look, well, let's take a closer look at it now. You can see that was a bit of footage through turn one. So they come down a long straight, which is up at the back of your screen here, and basically they're coming down that straight into turn one. This is the jump, which is on kind of the return. It's all the way around the outside, a NASCAR-style oval, so big turn one, then a long straight, big turn two. That then goes into a tightening series of sort of hairpins. This is a long right-hander, which is on the inside. And that's the corner yesterday during the first practice session, which blew my mind in terms of the amount of grip they had. And the drivers were saying, they were just like, how hard can I turn in? They were just going faster and faster. I think Meek at one point did one lap where he was never less than 70% throttle for the whole
lap.
Insane. And that's on snow and ice. So that gives you an idea about the amount of grip. It's enormous.
And that's trusting your equipment, right? You know, trusting your equipment, trusting yourself, and it's going to get exciting. So we talk about all this, you know, background of being on ice, being on snow, but for the first time ever, we got this Jamaican first time on snow and ice, and Katie's with him now, Fraz.
Yeah, we were talking earlier that some of these guys had grown up in snow and ice and cold, but this man, he has to have a little of that Jamaican bobsled version of life within him.
Yeah, no, it's my first ice race, and so far it's going really good. Colder than, you know, I'm used to, so even indoors with all the heaters, I got my jacket on and suit zipped up and my hat on, but, you know, it's good vibes in the tent. All the teams are underneath this one tent. And, yeah, looking forward to getting the race and going.
He just was on the track for the first time in snow and ice last week in Finland. Good luck out there tonight. Guys, it's time to get to some racing.
Ding, ding. You hear that? This is a boxing match. We got the battles. That's what's going down right now. Robin Larson, he gets a bye. What does that mean? Because he was the fastest dude out there on the course. The rest of them are going to have to do battle. But obviously, first, we start out with Connor Martell and Ollie Bennett.
Yeah, we do. So basically, there's nine cars here. Obviously, there's only eight places in the quarterfinals, which you can see are up next. Martell and Bennett. So normally, we get to this position from those battle bracket seeding races. We've not done them today. Look at that ice skating in the background. Lovely preserved ice. That's what we're looking to do. So we knock those on the head. We're going straight to the battle brackets. And the slowest two from timed practice earlier today will fight for that last spot in the quarterfinals. Then it's eight cars down to one for the top qualifier. Oh, look at that.
It looks so good. Nitro Rallycross making history. All electric, nearly 1,000 horsepower. We're going into our battle brackets. And here we go. You see those yellow lenses that Connor Martell's wearing. That's going to brighten your vision. It's going to kind of go HD with it all being white. You can go snowblind.
It gives you more contrast. So that's basically, the drivers are saying, and you'll have seen this if you've ever watched WRC Sweden, you see it with the cross-country skiers often as well, the yellow lens, even if you've been up the mountain yourself, it just allows you to see light and shade in a little bit more detail, which is tough, especially when the light's flat. Not so, it's probably easier tonight under the floodlights.
And here we go, Connor Martell, Ollie Bennett, the 21 of Connor Martell, Vermont Sports Car, Ollie Bennett, Excite Energy Racing. Jensen Button not joining us here, but Austin Meek is definitely a threat. Here we go, talking about that start, and we'll get into basically what the racecraft is and what you ideally want to do to get grip. Here we go, Connor Martell on the outside, Ollie Bennett gets out front of Connor Martell. And remember, keep in mind, two laps for these battle brackets.
Yeah, so look at the amount of roost that we're getting. Now, we had a lot of fresh snow. We're talking in UK, European terms, sort of 10, 12 centimetres here, 4 inches of snow, and that fell from 3 a.m. last night. So that's put loose snow down on the surface, and that means we get a lot of roost. So Travis Pastrana was like, dude, the one thing I never thought of was that they wouldn't be able to see it. It was like, yes, mate. Like, the snow dust comes up without a breeze there. It can be anyway. Now, Connor's going to go Joker straight away because, Jared, these battle brackets are two laps only. So I think you can expect the person in P2 every time is going to go on lap one. And then on lap two, you'll see the other driver respond. So Martel now he's got a bit better vision. Nail the lap time. Try and close down. It's 3.7 is the gap now. So I reckon, what, maybe three, the Joker lap.
Connor Martel's looking for Ollie Bennett to make some mistakes. And Connor Martel, you see him working that wheel, going, hitting that handbrake, getting that car to rotate. The car's going to grip back. Those Yokohama tires with those studs, 300 plus. And let's see that gap there, 3.9 seconds. You can see the green and the purple. What do the green and the purple denote there, Coley, as far as...
So that's sector time, Jared. Yeah, sorry, I was just checking something on the screen. So you can see the white flags out for the last lap. So basically, yeah, purple sector is the very best sector overall. You see Bennett had actually done that on the first lap, but if you look at Martel now in sector number three, he's managed to close a bit of time down. It's saying 3.8 on our timing screens at the moment, but he went a little bit quicker in that last sector.
Ollie Bennett looked like he lost a little bit of speed there. He kind of checked up. Now Connor Martel's trying to go for the pass. As you can see, Ollie Bennett going for the Yokohama Tire Joker lap, and Ollie Bennett holds on to it. Looks like Connor Martel might be shut out for the finals. Ollie Bennett kicks it sideways. Here we go. Who's going to get the win and move on to go against Robin Larson in the eight?
Look at that fantastic onboard, Jared. Gives you an idea of how hard they're working the cars, but also the visibility in there. He's up so close. Looks to the inside line of Bennett on the final corner.
And there we go. You can see Ollie Bennett does hold on to the lead. Connor Martel nipping at his heels, but just not enough track left. With two laps, you really got to keep it tight and right. And Ollie Bennett was, oh, man, looks like Connor Martel. What's that? And it looks like, yeah, there, and there it is. Checkered flag right there, and there it is. So Ollie Bennett gets the victory. The finish line a little extended on the end there. So, and Ollie Bennett, Excite Energy Racing, gets the victory. Connor Martel is looking from the outside. The Canadian flag waving in the wind. So you got to think, you know, it might be 3 degrees Celsius, but with the wind chill, we got some fans out here enjoying it. And this Trois-Rivieres track, really cool. You got a casino, you got a track. I mean, there's so many things going on here. It's really cool and historic driving into here.
You can nurse a beer for a long time in this weather, Jared, and it won't get warm. You know, there are advantages to it being very cold. I mean, we're talking about being a little bit warm for the track surface. Don't get us wrong. It is still very, very cold.
Yeah.
You know? It's below freezing point. It really is. Good drive by Bennett.
Great drive by Bennett. Connor Martel was looking for him to make some mistakes, and Connor definitely, I don't know his total ice background and his snow background, definitely an accomplished driver. Him and TP were talking about it. Do you know his background?
Yeah, he's done plenty of rallying, so, you know, he's on top of it. I think the thing is here, this is so different with the cars being different, wider tires, so many starts. So everybody's learning about it. I think what's important to note there is Bennett won the start, and there wasn't anything Martel could do about it. In one lap, he didn't have enough time to edge him in terms of the sector time. So the start's crucial, and I'm seeing a little bit of a slope on the start as well. So analysis mode on. We'll keep you posted.
Yeah, it's really exciting. That's a great start. You know, just getting out there, clean racing, keeping the cars together, keeping the track together. You know, attrition, making sure that we have the best show for the final. We have different classes between side-by-sides, rear-wheel drive, and all-wheel drive as we take a look overhead of this massive track. And as you're talking about, the traditional big oval coming in on the road course, it reminds me of like a big Indy kind of course. It's big oval, then you got a road course in the middle. That's really kind of what it comes down to. So the eight has been shaped. You see Larson versus Bennett, Erickson versus Backrud, McConnell versus Meek, and then finally Ollie Erickson versus Travis Pastrana. That should be a good one. And you can see how we knock it down to the two semifinals, and then finally who will hold up that TQ top qualifier belt and who will get our first ever ICE TQ spot. But then tomorrow is game day, baby. We'll see as many as all eight cars. You know, only one will be watching from the side in our finals. And we'll get you home by dinner time, baby. It's awesome.
Look at that track.
Yeah, it looks fantastic. Got the baseball field over. Like I said, I mean, there's so many things going on here. And
there's an ice hockey rink in the next building across. Yep. I've been here several times in the summer, and the ice hockey rink always used to park the golf carts because it was never frozen at that time of year. But we're not in there this time. It's frozen outside this time of year, so we're all good. But it really is spectacular. It's a horse-trotting track, which is where the banking comes from around the outside. So all the cars are being tended to in stable blocks and stuff nearby. We've got a big tent for the Group E vehicles. We've got some support. core categories as well, Canadian side-by-side and Canadian rally, but it really is spectacular. I'm loving being under the lights again, like Phoenix on the Friday night, and of course we'll be racing during daylight hours tomorrow, so I'm interested to know whether I think the yellow glasses might be better tomorrow, maybe on that infield that's in the shade, Jared, they're a little bit more useful, but it'll be allowing the drivers to pick out things like the ruts.
I mean, you got to utilize everything. You really got to try it all right now, especially because keep in mind, we have another snow round, and it's going to be even colder in Calgary. I mean, we're going to Alberta, Canada, and it's going to be, I mean, it could be as low as, I mean, shoot, 0 degrees Fahrenheit.
Yeah,
could
that's
somebody
cold.
Looked it up, and they said, negative 20 or something like that?
Yeah, it is, yeah. It's going to be
crazy.
Well, that was, of course, the venue for the 1988 Winter Olympics, which is where the Jamaican bobsleigh team were. And we're looking forward to seeing Fraser McConnell bring some ice action to Jamaica there as well.
Yeah, all right. So as we're getting things prepped here, again, let's throw it down to Katie. It's cold, but things are still heating up in that Group E paddock.
Heating up indeed, at least for Ollie Bennett. That was a great run and actually got him on the line. Congratulations for that start, because that really was a seal in the deal, if you will.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, we're only doing two laps tonight, so everything is on the start. Obviously, there's dust on this track, so if you can get position on the start, that's the majority of the work done, so you've just got to stay in front then. So yeah, it's really good. Enjoyed it.
There was no issues for you prior to that, of course, but your team has been busy and working. And what's the attitude around here right now? Because they already look exhausted.
Yeah, I think I owe the boys a few beers tonight. They've been flat out. They've took out the whole gearbox of Chris's car, put a new gearbox in. He got on the line seconds before his heat. But yeah, we're both now into the qualifying battles. So yeah, it's going to end on a high, hopefully, but the day's not over.
You know, one of the things I thought was so cool was when you got your first final in Nitro Rallycross. Obviously, the pursuit is there again today to be there tomorrow. How confident are you that it's going to happen?
Yeah, I'm pretty confident. I think the team are doing a great job with the cars. Me and Chris, I'm learning a lot from Chris, obviously a former WRC champion. He gives me a lot of confidence in what I'm doing. And that's shown now. I've won another battle. I nearly got to the final with Travis at the last event in the battle. So yeah, we're going to push on today and see where we end up.
Pushing on indeed. Thank you.
Cheers, thank you.
Modern performance energy drink created for today's active generation. Yokohama Tire, make every drive a performance. My Energy, driving the charge to a sustainable future. We're seeing our first battle there, and we're getting our first taste of another class, another variety here, but just getting that track prepped, and maybe tell them how they maintain this track, because you know we get water trucks, but we still have water trucks here, and kind of an interesting dynamic.
We
no Zamboni machine.
I think we could do with one, to be honest. We water the dusty tracks to keep the dust down. Here we're watering the track actually to build the ice up. So over the last couple of weeks, they take out like the big water tanker and they run it round, and the banking really helps. So yesterday we were watching. After the first couple of runs, they ran the tanker around the top and they literally opened the taps, let the water run down the bank and let it freeze. Ideally, you want about minus 15 Celsius. What's that? 0 Fahrenheit, yep. Roughly. If there's any weather people out there, sorry about that. What was it Kate said earlier? I'm no meteorologist. But the colder it is, obviously, the quicker it freezes. So it's a real balance like anything, and hats off to the track people. Just working their tails off again to make sure that we've got an awesome surface to race on.
Yeah, and these tires are shredded up. So, again, just keeping that track consistent, making sure that, you have ideal conditions. Love the jump. Little small hip, kind of roller. You see how just throwing the attitude of the vehicles. FC1X, some people were wondering how the electric vehicles would handle the conditions. Seems to be holding up all good.
Yeah, normally it's battery, so you get lower duration on a battery in cold conditions, but we don't really worry about duration. We're not kind of worried, saving energy or doing regen. We're just like, let's get all the energy into... Chris Meek did actually say the amount of studs he was like, the amount of power we've got, he was worried he might just gun it off the line and snap all four drive shafts, which I thought was pretty funny. But they can still get a lot of wheel spin if they go too high on the power. Learn. Literally everybody in the paddock is like, we just don't know.
And you were talking... I kind of teased that earlier. Yeah. Kevin Erickson was kind of the test mule, the first guy to get out there. He pulled on track and just dropped it, for lack of a better term, kind of dropped the clutch, but there's no clutch. And it just ripped up the snow and the ice. He says, don't go at 100%, go at 40%, roll into it.
Hey,
Yeah, I know. I've been hiding like Ollie Erickson has. Nice to see you. It's good to be back. It's nice to be in. I feel like your weather and your temperature and your life, where you come from. Is this similar to it?
Yeah, this is where the Swedes have half of the year. So I bet for you Californians, it's a bit cold up here. But yeah.
Yeah, our gear is very different.
Yeah, I guess. I'm not wearing that much clothes either. I guess we have a different skin, our Scandinavians, but it's all fun.
As it relates to the driving on these kinds of conditions, of course, some of us normal people who are not race car drivers think we can drive in the ice and the snow. Break it down for us as a driver, especially with these studs on the tires, what that real difference is.
Yeah, it's a big difference because you need to get the studs to work. It's not only like you're depending on a surface grip that's always there. Here we have to make the claws dig the whole time. Now we have a car.
By the way, where we are right now in the pits, the cars are coming by us as we're having these interviews and conversations. And so it is one of those things where we're balancing and you can't hear these cars because they're electric. So, but yes, you're talking a little bit about making sure that the studs are working in the way they should be.
Yeah, and at the same time, we don't have any grooves in these tires. So as soon as we hit some snow, we don't get the studs through the ice and we lose all the grip. So it's a fine balance trying to read the track at the same time. And now in the dark today, it will be a bit tough. So yeah, the cars will skid a bit everywhere and we just have to be ready for it.
So no advantage for the fact that you grew up in Sweden and this is like a simple driving style for you?
Yeah, maybe it should be.
So we shall see.
Yeah, I saw the bet race. We were betted quite well. All of our Scandinavians were in the top there. So yeah, we'll see. I mean, the driving style is kind of similar to gravel anyways, where most people are used to by now. But yeah, it's all about reading how the snow affects the tires and how that affects the grips. That's the key.
All right, we will see you a little later on. Thank you, Ollie. Gentlemen, Coley, I think I'm kind of curious if for you, you think that the Scandinavian skin, as Ollie just said, the Scandinavian skin will come out and actually be an advantage for those who kind of grew up on snow and ice and cold weather. What's your take?
I think, obviously, anybody who's used to sliding around snow and ice on a studded tire, in theory, should be an advantage. But the trouble is, as we've been saying, is just this is so different. So the traditional rally tire is a narrow tire, has a lot of studs on it. The idea of the narrow tire is it puts more weight in a smaller patch. So if you want to say, if you put all the studs together that are on the ground, it's about the size of a nickel or a pound coin. It's very little contact patch. And on a narrow tire, it pushes that hard down into the ground. This is a wide tire, 325 studs. They're bolted through. It's 1,000 horsepower. There's a tire on the right. Doesn't look like that. It's not some sort of max device. Yeah.
Yeah.
They won't drop studs like the rally tires do when they overheat. They drop the studs out because these are actually drilled through. So they shave the carcass of the Yokohama off. You can see just on the shoulder, Jared, where the wet tread was. Drill it through. It's a pattern. So all the tires are the same. They put the pattern on the outside. Then there's a liner on the inside to stop it leaking through. And they're a crazy bit of kit.
The YMDs, Yokohamas of mass destruction. So I think Meek is one to watch too. Once his equipment gets tight. And another guy to watch is a gentleman that has all the fun when it comes to Nitro Rallycross. He's joined us the entire of the season. Always love hanging out with this dude. Always cooking up a good thing. Always cooking up a good time. Streetback Tommy, where are you at?
What's up, everybody? Street Bike Tommy, and I'm here with Matt with Urban Adrenaline. I'm down here at this really cool park they got going on. It's a big facility.
On est à Adrenaline Urbaine, ici à Trois-Rivières, and we're gonna get this on. Are you ready to do some snowboarding?
Oui, oui.
That's it. Let's go.
Yeah.
Lap loud. Hey. Yo.
Yeah.
That's the next step.
He looks pretty cool. Look at the progression.
Oh my God.
I'm an athlete.
No, you just gotta grab the rope. He can do it. Keep on going.
He's got the mark.
Yeah. Yeah. 1, 2, 3.
Oh, here we go. How does the brake work?
All right.
That's it!
Trettonet.
Dernege.
Trettonet Dernege.
What is that?
So sick. I got this. Oh, shit. Oh. I was trying to do a trick. Oh, thanks, Matt. That was super fun. I feel like I've run out my awesome. I'm going to have a little rest. Thank you very much.
Yeah, my pleasure, Tommy.
Just hang out and have a second. Oh, geez. I'm over this place.
All right, so Tommy's having a good time. He's just trying to go for a rest, and he ended up jumping over him. But that place is right next to our hotel, and I had no idea what it was. And then, oh, Tommy, you're going to go over there and hang out. It's just this cool, like hotel building.
Skate park downstairs, and then they've got the snowboard park, basically, on the roof. It is cool. I don't know if you've ever fallen over on one of those boxes, but a slam like that hurts, man. That is literally, she's fallen over on it. Like, the only way I can describe it is like a very hard wooden box with scaffold poles down on the other side. Imagine falling over on that hard. And Tommy's, he's hardcore.
That was
not comfortable. There's Travis.
There we are in the paddock, and Travis signed some autographs. Double thumbs up, and again, the homage, the KB Forever livery there, and Travis always got a smile on his face. And, you know, obviously a massive star of Nitro Rallycross and the Nitro family. He's the unofficial mayor, but he's just as much of a competitor than anybody else. Even though, you know, obviously he helped build Nitro brand, does not mean by any means that he's going to be a champion or he's going to win an event. And keep in mind, he is the reigning champion right now and defending champion.
Yeah, he's the reigning champion. When I spoke to him yesterday, I said, what have we got to do? We've got four events left. Yeah, he's P5 in the standings. There is going to be a dropped score, so their worst score will go, but still that doesn't move him up super close to the likes of Larson and Backerud. And he was like, well, look, I just have to win. Yeah. So he's got to go. There is where Larson can afford to roll it back a little bit if he wants to and chill, he can. Stephanie McConnell, Fraser's mum, is just looking into the tent at the back here with her Jamaica hat on.
If you have the Jamaican flag on you, you get warmer immediately. So
Bring the rum already,
the rum.
Stephanie.
Bring the rum. Stephanie's having a good time. And again, the bottle rum will be over here in a moment, right as soon as we finish our production. But there it is, hashtag KB Forever. Katie, what's up?
Well, standing by maybe... standing by with maybe one of the most disappointed guys out here, even though one could say it's a lot of fun, is Connor Martel. Disappointing heat. You had mentioned if you can't see anything out here in the snow, it's real difficult.
Yeah, it's really hard to start behind anybody and then be able to gain on them because you can't see anything. Once you're a certain distance, it's really bad. And the warm temperatures make it, as soon as it hits your windshield, it turns to slush. So then you have to, like, it doesn't just go over your windshield. So it's really difficult. I did Rally X Nordic in 2018, and it was the same way. If you can be right behind somebody, you mostly can see. But if you're at all, like, 10 yards away from them, you're blind. So definitely disappointing. We've had kind of a tough start to the weekend, and the track is super fun, but it's brutal. It'll catch you off guard really quick. So tomorrow's a new day, and hopefully we'll come back.
You talk about the visibility, and hopefully you do come back. You talk about that visibility, and someone earlier had said that dust, being in the snow, is actually harder to see than being in, like, a dust storm as well. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, dust is, you can kind of see through the dust a little bit, where with the snow, and especially at night with the lights, and all the snow blends together, so you completely lose yourself on the track. When it's dusty, you can still see, like, the edges of the track. But when it's white dust and snow, you can't make the difference of anything. So it's difficult.
Thank you for your time here. It's time for some racing, though Connor Martel will not be out there tonight.
And here we are getting ready to send it. You can see the side-by-side. So we are seeing a variety of different classes from Group E, side-by-sides, Rally 2-wheel drive, and Rally 4-wheel drive. Mark Meyer, you can see all the Canadian flags here. Mark Meyer, Bertrand Lambert, Greg Michaud, and a variety of drivers talking about them. Jacques Asselin, Mark Meyer. Go ahead. What do you got, Coleman?
So Gregoire Michaud, just a reminder for everyone, Gregoire is taking part in the NRX side-by-side series. Yes. So this is separate. This is Canadian side-by-side. So we have off the line. And looking at the vehicles immediately, you'll see the different styles. So the one up front on pole, that's not even really a side-by-side. It's because you sit next to each other. No, that's a solo. All the way around the outside, though, with an incredible pass. Looking forward to seeing if that happened in Group E. See the snow roost. Imagine being further back in the pack. But, Jared, this isn't one make. Like, we have, remember the Slimmery class? They're all the same.
Yeah, they're Can-Am. You go to a spec class with the Can-Ams. But here you got a variety. You can see the different machines, the different height, the different tires. So it's basically run what you brung. So you can see Michaud, who has a lot of experience. He's been racing in the Can-Am in, as you say, the celebrity, the spec class, whatever you want to call it. But Meyer sits in second, Lambert in third, and Michaud in fourth. And it looks like Michaud slides up to second. So you got two Michauds out front. Villiard, Tafoe, Tardif, and Morrison bring up the rear. And we just got a teaser of, you know, we talked to Connor Martell. He says, you can't drive, you can't see. Like you said, these things throw up a lot of dust. And keep in mind, a lot of them don't have windscreens.
Yeah,
they just have tear-offs or they have the visors on their helmets.
It is cold in there, I'm telling you that right now. You're getting showered in snow the whole time you're in the car. Look at the lead from Michaud, backing it in here. I say, the spec of these cars is massively different. So not only are they not all Can-Ams, here we've got some Polaris, even a Yamaha out there as well. They're allowed to choose whatever tyres they want. Now, they're mostly going to run a knobbly tyre with a kind of a 4mm stud on it, so not like a rally stud. Look at the inputs again. One of my favourite things about side-by-sides is here you get to see with the FC1, sometimes you don't see those inputs, but watch the front wheels. You particularly see it from the drone shot. Look at the amount of times that the steering angle's changing in one corner, and even on the straight, you're working these things all the while. There you go, here you go. Look at this again. Look, back it in, get it straight, try and get the power down.
And these tires are more traditional to what you would see Austin Meek or a stage rally car. You know, they're running leaner, narrower tires as opposed to a big wide tire, kind of going with more of the track, more of a snowmobile as opposed to kind of a big tire that we're seeing on the Group E vehicles.
Yeah, we've got three different types of tires out here. So these guys are all going to want what I would call a donut profile. So like it's a round tire. Doesn't really matter what angle the camber is at. You've got a similar contact patch the whole way through the corner. They're studded. The rally cars are going to run the sort of tire that you would have seen on Rally Sweden. So that's much more of the rally tire, which is with the knobble, but also with a 7mm stud on the top of it. Flashing lights on the back, that's actually really useful if you don't want to get rear-ended out on track, because you can see them out of roost there is, and that allows the driver in front to be able to see just about where you are and maybe pick your spot. Look at the difference as well, Jared, in light. We often talk about how when the sun's low, how tricky it is. Here they're coming right out into the brightness and then into the dark again.
And you can see Michaud with so much dominance out there. Both, it looks like GM Michaud and then Sergei Michaud. And I apologize if I butchered your name, but...
Don't worry, man. It's all good. We're trying.
Yeah, you know, there's no try. There's only do, right, as Yoda says. So we got the white flag out here, final lap, and Michaud out front. And it looks like the S Michaud.
Serge Michaud in second, Grégoire Michaud out front. Now, one of the side-by-side guys said to me yesterday, you know what, it's Grégoire that we're expecting to take this. It's Grégoire who's at the top of the standings at the minute, Jared, in side-by-side in NRX. It's a good performance so far. He's dominant out front. Remember, say, not all of these cars are the same spec. One of the competitors out there actually only got his side-by-side in the summer. It's literally a standard one. He's put a tuned pipe and a tuned inlet on it, had a different map put on the engine. And he basically bought it for fun. He's come and done a couple of races here, and he's absolutely loving the chance to get out here with Nitro Rallycross, which is cool.
All right, so it looks like the other Michaud dropped back all the way to sixth and has yet to hit that Joker lap, so might have some technical issues. But Meyer sits in second. There you go. Michaud hits it. So Meyer and Lambert sitting in second and third. Villiard Tufaut sitting in the fifth. And I believe Jonathan Tufaut, I'm familiar with the name. I hope that's Jonathan Tufaut. He competes in drifting. Jonathan Tufaut, I've announced his name in the drifting world. And just a dominant performance there by Michaud out front. And Meyer, look at that, 9 seconds behind. I mean, absolutely flexing on him. And it looks like a battle for, no, not second or third. So Meyer and then Lambert brings up, no, Lambert jumps to second. Villiard, so no, look at that, Lambert second, Villiard in third.
I think let's just say, I think stuff has happened, Jared, because Meyer has dropped down from what was looking like P2 all the way down to P5 on that last lap. So maybe a bit of carnage in the background down in amongst the snowbanks.
Yeah, right there. So there's the 72. Yeah, so the 72 of Sergei Michaud. Something happened, might have gotten to those banks. And, you know, Katie was talking to Andreas Backer. When you get into the soft stuff, that's going to bite back and it's going to really eat up your car. Maybe even go end over end. I mean, we've seen some pretty sensational accidents throughout the season. You know, there were a few drivers of Can-Ams that we've had in previous rounds that want to join us. Leticia Bafani, I know, you know, again, Leah Block, Ken Block's oldest daughter, she raced in it a couple races, both in Glen Helen and in Phoenix, so California and Arizona. And a culmination of semifinal one, side-by-sides, pretty exciting in the snow and in the ice, and just seeing the variety of machines. I know you have a great affinity for side-by-sides.
Yeah,
and,
man.
And we've got behind the wheel of one, which you very well might see throughout this weekend.
Wasn't quite the same spec.
We were just trying to chill.
No. Dominic Winlett for Grégoire Michaud, 10.2 seconds up the road. But I think the fact that a minute separates P1 to P9. Yeah, I think a Canadian will win. But remember, in this, there are some different spec cars out there, and they've got open choice in terms of tyres and also the spec of the vehicles as well. So not the same sort of side-by-side you're seeing, but we're really grateful to have the Canadian guys along with us here at Trois-Rivières.
All right, so as we are getting prepared for our next class, we're going to be seeing Rally 2-wheel drive and Rally 4-wheel drive. Bit of a smaller class, but it's still really exciting. We're seeing a few drivers that are taking their drift cars out here, their backup cars. Says, you know what? Let's go ahead. Let's have some fun, right?
Yeah, man. Looking forward to it. We've been having fun all season, of course. We've got a bit of spare time this weekend, so we thought we'd take you back and show you some of the fantastic racing we've had so far in Nitro Rallycross, going over the winter break and over Christmas from 22 into 23. This time round, we're going to go back and have a look at that incredible final from Glen Helen.
Fraz has to get a good jump right here. I think Andreas Bakkerad, Brian Larson, teammates, they're going to work it into that second corner. The track is prepped the best that it's ever been.
So McConnell versus Larson on row one. You heard from Travis, the track's in great condition. Jared Deander's back up here in commentary with us. Who's going to take it round four of Nitro Rallycross? Will it be Fraser McConnell on the inside line with a good start? Can Larson hold on around the outside? Oh, it's a good start by Larson. Gets alongside McConnell immediately. McConnell going to try and run him wide. Backward. Larson's teammates right in there. They get straight into a line. McConnell going to go defensive up at turn one. It's one of the Ericssons up into P4 already sideways in the background. I think Martel might have made it. Flings it into turn one. It's an epic start by Fraser McConnell. That's how you start the race.
Fraser McConnell comes out unscathed, and the RX Cartel, the DRRJC guys, they're getting into each other. Is that a smart move, Travis?
No, but I tell you what, Larson, man, you saw Kevin Erickson, lots of wheel spin over there. Ollie Bennett kind of getting up in there. This is a wild start, but Larson is proving that he is a championship contender, and no matter what happens, he is getting it up and putting it in wherever he can. He is making the best of every single corner.
Now, Larson didn't give up the win, Travis. You took some serious risks at ERX with a huge jump and managed to gap Larson. He knows he's got that big championship lead out front. He's not going to give that up yet, is he? Surely he'll have a few cracks at trying to get McConnell.
No, you need the win, and McConnell needs this win more than anybody. McConnell's not going to do anything other than go wide open. Now, he's got to watch out. A lot of these guys are over-jumping the jumps, and they're saying, oh, the tires are going off.
Larson, Joker, straight away.
So everyone's really fast, but Larson's going to come behind some of the other drivers, so he's going to have a little bit more in his windscreen. He's betting that he is the faster driver, and that's why he took the Joker so early.
And you talked about the tires yesterday. You got to think, this is the most amount of laps they're doing, so they're holding four laps, it's six laps. Can you hold the tires together?
Absolutely. The tires are great. It's when you push too hard, you overjump a jump, you have to land sideways to get these heavy cars to maneuver. They have a lot of horsepower, but if you jump too far, you pitch in like Fraz is doing, you're taking risks when you hit
You're flirting with it.
Oh, yeah.
Larson's Joker was perfectly timed. He's also covered off Kevin Erickson. So Erickson, Bennett, and Martel went Joker very early on, and Larson's covered him off. So at 5.9 back, Robin Larson is just about within reach of McConnell. Jared, we know that split is about 6 seconds.
Larson right on the inside, not taking any chances with the tires. He is doing everything perfect, but Fraz is flying.
The flying Jamaican. Look at the A-Shock Energy vehicle out front. He's got that clean air. Look at how much, you know, you're seeing a lot of dirt in Backerud's face, and he's navigating through it. But again, taking that Joker lap, Larson, is that going to pay off?
Larson's taking another 10th out of McConnell, so watch out for the yellow-colored RX Cartel machine.
Kevin Erickson giving Larson everything he can handle. Those guys are battling back and forth back there. That is going to hurt Larson, but Larson doesn't have anyone in front of him. He's got clear vision. That is huge. You look at all the windscreen. Some of these guys can't see anything heading into the sun.
He's all over the back of him. He's right.
Factor.
He's all over the back. You're on board with Larson now. What you can't see is behind how close Kevin Erickson is. So if Kevin Erickson can slow Larson down, and indeed the gap's gone up to 6.1, so Erickson interfering with Larson is slowing him down. 0.3 seconds per second.
For
now
Fraz,
five have gone towards Fraz.
He's not slowing him down. Fraz is just flat flying
He
out
is
front.
Ripping. I mean, he's throwing it sideways over that A-Shock Energy gap jump.
I'm talking about Larson. Larson's being held up by Ericsson behind him. It was down to 4.8, and the pressure Kevin's putting on has gone up to 6.4.
I agree, but it's not Larson or Kevin. It's the fact that those two, Backrew was the fastest here last year, and definitely the Jamaican out front, Fraz McConnell, he is on fire right now. They are ripping.
All right, so Fraser McConnell, and then you see Backeroo there in second. Do you think he's kind of waiting for strategy-wise, or he's just trying to get up to him, and Fraz just pulling away?
No, Backeroo's doing everything that he possibly can to get
fastest
there.
Fastest
lap of the day. He is on it, too. Oliver Ericsson been fastest in a lot of these practice sessions. He needs this win, but Oliver has been sending it so sideways on the jumps. He's getting a lot of flats. We'll see if it's going to pay off. He looks straighter now.
Backeroo's giving himself no chance here tactically in terms of Joker lap. So they're coming onto the final lap now. You would have thought he might have gone on lap five, Travis.
No team strategy. He wants ahead of his teammate. He wants every point for this championship. Yep. He wants to get in the lead after this one.
I mean, there's a lot of races still left. Here we are, round four of the championship. There's still plenty of rounds left. So you got to think, you know, are you thinking championship? You're trying to win, and Fraser McConnell trying to make it a perfect event. He wins the TQ yesterday, his first ever, and now here he is leading the pack. One lap left to go, and the white flag is out. Fraser McConnell, can the A-Shot Jamaican pilot do it?
Get a half
top
to go,
three
Joker.
And the next three, and they are all almost identical. Fraz looking really good, and actually, I mean,
this
as tiny as Fraz gets, it's really slick coming into here. This is a big one.
So watch for the
inside.
Watch for the merge. Watch for the merge. Wait for Larson to come over the gap jump. This is going to be for the win. Larson on the inside line. Fraser McConnell's there, though. Larson can't quite close him down. Backward into his teammate. Larson
and his
teammate. Fraser McConnell, though, with just a corner to go. The Jamaican flicks it into that left-hander now.
Oh, boy.
It's been an absolutely brilliant performance by the Jamaican. The crowd will be on their feet for this. It's going to be a first-ever Nitro Rallycross victory for Fraser McConnell.
Last corner. I got
brilliant
on the last
performance by him.
Oh, look at this. Everybody
every carnage in the background. Here he comes. Fraz with a P1. P2 goes Robin Larson. Backwards going to get P3.
Wow.
Oh, photo
Ollie
finish.
Bennett,
Yes!
The emotions run deep for the 35. Fraser McConnell gets his first ever win. It's a perfect event, baby. He gets EQ, he gets the pole, and he gets the win from start to finish. Fraz puts it together for Jamaica.
Yes! Look how much it means. Look at that.
Well, my man Jared's got to get himself some hand warmers. I've got some already. It's pretty cold in here, but we're good. We're getting ready for some decent hot action on track at least. Now, earlier on today, Jared Deander was out on track with Ollie Ericsson, and here's what they had to talk about on a very icy, slippery Trois-Rivieres circuit.
That's right, we're making history. For the first time ever, the all-electric FC1X hits the snow and the ice. We are making history. I'm super excited to be here, and this gentleman's excited to be here. Now, Ollie, give us some tips on how to be the fastest and get the victory on this historic track.
Yeah, the biggest difference on ice compared to gravel, for example, is on gravel, the surface is all that matters, how to get the traction from the surface. Here it's all about the tire, how to get the tire to dig. So you want to enter corners really sideways, get on the throttle early, and just get those studs.
Yeah. Get the claws. Yeah, get the claws. Just dig it in, right? Yeah. And what's interesting is when we stepped, you know, we're using cramps here. They're just kind of slip-on spikes. You got them on Jordans, coincidentally. So I don't know if that's the proper. I mean, you're so comfortable on the snow and the ice. But we walked on it right now. The track's going to change, just like the dirt, the blue groove. We've seen it. Loose gravel, clay, all these different types. Ice and snow, it's not consistent throughout the event, right?
No, for sure. It's all about heat and air, how hard the ice gets. If it's softer, obviously, it grips up worse because you have less.
You're losing traction. It's slushy or icier, and that's actually going to cut. You kind of, where do you want the ice? Where do you want the snow? Really kind of frozen hard?
Yeah, a frozen hard ice is more grip, obviously.
That's ideal.
Because it's like digging through concrete, but you have these big claws that can get through it. You know.
I love it.
But also, it rots up very, very easily also on ice. So it gets kind of a wavy rut.
Yeah.
And if you get a perfect hook in the rut, you can go incredibly fast. But you can also slip out of it super easy and hit the snowbank in 150 miles per hour. So it's a small edge there.
Little window there. And it's very unpredictable because, you know, when you're asphalt, you see that blue groove or you see the dirt when it's dry. Here, you might have a snow cone, you might have a slushy, or you might have an ice rink.
Yeah, for sure. It's all about feel, you know. You got to enter, pray to the gods, and hope you don't end up in a snowbank.
Pray to the snow god, pray to the ice god. Well, we talk about claws, we talk about fangs. Again, that's a target on his back. A lot of Scandos that are here, ready to do battle here at this historic track.
I found them. I got them. Got a little hotties right here from my pocket and these things. That's why my hands. Every shot I'm seeing myself, I'm like this. Everybody's like, dude, we can get gloves. I have gloves. I just prefer to be like this.
So, yeah, man.
You know, I think it's really cool. Some great insight there from Ollie Erickson. You know, him and the Olsbergs camp. You know, they developed the vehicle, and we talk about just his background and their background. I think it's pretty cool. And again. I mean, what are your thoughts, Katie? What about you? What's kind of the sentiments going around? I know it's really loud down there. It's quiet because those Group E vehicles are quiet, so watch your back. But what are the sentiments? What's kind of the energy you're feeling down there?
Really good question. And I think one of the conversations that I just had with Robin Larson about the energy and the focus has to do with chasing down the championship. You know, for some of these guys, it's the second half of the season, and that's the eyes on the prize. Robin Larson's one of them. You can see him climbing in the car right now. He said that he's been feeling championship vibes since round three. He said, realistically, though, it's about the championship, but it all starts on a day like today. I mean, you two know that, right? He's getting in this car right now, setting himself up so that he is in good position for tomorrow's race. And as he had mentioned, the strategy, play it safe tonight so it doesn't blow it. So the starting position really is where he wants to be, guys.
Yeah, and what's also interesting is we're going to go to another snow track. And thank you so much, Katie. We're going to wrap out about thank you, Katie. And, you know, we're going to another snow track in Calgary. And then we go back to a track where we've been to previously, right, this year, and it's a doubleheader,
yeah.
Glen Helen.
Yeah,
that's official. It's going down in March. Glen Helen, doubleheader. A champion will be crowned in California.
Larson's in that interesting situation, isn't he, where he's been on the podium 5 out of 6 times this year. He had once off the podium. That's an incredible record. He's always been in the final, and he's just done a really good job. And he needs to. He said to me yesterday, I must qualify well today, because if I don't qualify well, you're further back in the pack. If you're back in the pack with all that snow roost, you know what's going to happen. So he's got a job to get done here. Where Katie says he's going to play it safe, he is, but he must win. He has to win. He's got to go as long as he can in qualifying and get himself as far up the grid of those heat races tomorrow as he can.
Some great insight there from Katie, and we're just trying to get kind of all the different angles and different perspectives. So catching up with Ollie, catching up with Katie, and she's obviously catching up with all the drivers. Just different perspective, and that's, you know, we're in the booth, they're down on the ground. We have all these great people that have, you know, been part of this circus that is Nitro Rallycross local, you know, track maintenance and everybody. Thank you so much. But it's all about insight, so we caught up with some more personalities of Nitro Rallycross.
A special guest here, the Secretary of Commerce, Francois Champagne. Yes, I like that. And he is the Minister of Industry, Innovation, and Science here in Canada. Welcome first to Nitro Rallycross.
Well, thank you. I should say welcome to Canada. Actually, welcome to the greenest race in the world. That's what you're saying, because actually not only those are electric cars, but you know that they're feeding off the grid, which is 100% renewable. So we can say tonight, you know, in front of everyone, this is the greenest race ever in the world, and it's happening in Trois-Rivières in Quebec in Canada. So we're delighted to have you. We have people from Finland, from Sweden, Americans. This is great, and this is going to be fun. You should see these spikes. This is going to be really, really race.
Yeah, I'd like to call that our bling around here. But as it relates to being fun, you're right. This is also changing the game for motorsport in general. How do you see that from your point of view?
Well, we're seeing it everywhere. You know, we've got Formula One as well. We have NASCAR. We've been working with the NASCAR folks, actually. To try to bring race as green as possible. You know, we know the new generation, everyone wants us to do better, and we've been looking at biofuel, we've been looking at electric. But today what's exciting is actually, I think, the greenest race. So this is going to be, I hope, a game changer for the industry. We're talking also Formula One, how we can do that. It goes from the tires to the body to the engine to the batteries. And I would say Canada in that has been working very hard with the Federation, with all the racers. And I think it really appeals to the values of people. You know, we're in 2023 now, and people are really excited about that. And, you know, it's a bit cold, so we're testing. Yeah, this is good, actually, because the manufacturer can test the batteries under very cold condition. I mean, folks who are watching at home cannot feel it, but I can tell you it's probably minus 25 now. It doesn't look like that, but it's minus 25 outside the tent. And this is good because we can improve the performance of the battery, and this is key in terms of innovation. So we're really delighted to have all the folks here in Trois-Rivières and Quebec in Canada, and delighted to be on your network, because I think this is something to be celebrated for the weekend.
It is. It's a lot of fun, as you mentioned. We're creating green environments around here, and we appreciate your time to represent all of that here in Canada.
Well, welcome, and we hope to see you again next time. Bring your winter coat, you know. So we're happy to have you.
Guys.
Thank you so much, Katie, and thank you to Mr. Champagne there. And
what cool name.
I know. Right? That's not Mr. Coley, is it? You know?
No, Mr. Champagne, like popping bottles. And just celebrating, you know, like you said, the green aspect and all of these things kind of about renewable energy and all that. And just it's about perspective, you know, and it's really cool because a lot of people shoot holes. When I tell people, I'm like, yeah, Nitro Rallycross, it's all electric. You know what? It's all good, man. Like, give it a whirl.
So there are two French rallycross fans here from the Andreas Backwards fan club. Mm. I met them up on the balcony of the casino last night. They were like, you know what? I wasn't sure. I've never seen rallycross that wasn't internal combustion. They've watched the French championship a lot, which is still internal combustion. And he was like, wow, I can't believe how fast they are. They were 177 kilometers an hour, which is around 125 mile an hour at the end of the straight. 80 mile an hour in turn two on these studs. They're epically quick. They really are.
Yeah, so you can shoot holes in it, but guess what? They're going to shoot holes in you with a gravel machine gun that goes out back, baby, or ice machine gun, that is. This is earlier today, so this was our first and only battle we've seen of round one battle. This is Bennett versus Martel. Break down what you're seeing here.
So that's what I wanted to say, Jared. So what we're seeing first and foremost is where they are on the grid. Now, the person who is on pole, and this is new for this round, in all of the races from now on, so even in the heats right through to the final, they get to choose which side of the grid they want, and that's absolutely critical. So at the minute, we saw Bennett was on the inside, and he took the advantage from there. Now, you could say if you're high on the banking, you could take the outside line and use the banking to launch the car a little bit more downhill, but I'd say the fact that Bennett took the inside line, well, we'll see when we see more drivers whether or not they do that or not. From then on, the visibility wasn't so bad for Martel when he jokered on lap one, but you've then got to do the perfect lap.
You're already a step back, yeah. Because I think Martel lost it right out of turn two.
Yeah.
You know, you saw that, and he got right into just the dust storm or the sandstorm or the snowstorm and just couldn't see. He got blinded by the snow.
What some of the drivers are telling me as well is that when you're in the roost, actually the hardest thing, Jared, is we're riding on board now. Imagine being in the roost and then trying to pick out where that snowbank is on the inside and the outside. It's really hard to know how wide the car is and whether or not you're going to touch that inside line. That's the back straight. So at this point, Bennett's got a lap to go. And he knows he's going to be heading into his joker. This is up at turn three.
So now you're coming to the inside portion of the track.
The bump
dip.
Yep.
That little dip over there. Now coming into turn seven, right?
No, that's four, and then into joker. So he goes joker outside. So here he's in the joker. But watch Bennett. Particularly watch Bennett on this next right-hander. He lifts early, gets the car in early, and he doesn't allow it to run wide because Martel's got a run on him coming into there. Gets a little bit squirrely over the tabletop. They can fly the tabletop further, but you want to butter the landing. You don't want to land to flat. Then you get the car all squirrely on the braking zone up into turn seven. So this is into that left-handed hairpin. And I'll be completely honest, I thought the finish was here because that's where the start was. First time I've seen a race.
You got to go all the way around. So turn eight,
yeah,
and now you're going to finish it out, and you finish it on the other side of the track. So the start is not the finish. The finish is on the fan side, basically,
yeah,
where all the grandstands are.
Opposite the start.
Yeah. So you have another big left sweeper before you actually hit the finish line in front of the fans. There's a lot to navigate there, and we're talking about, you know, two-wheel drive and all-wheel drive class. They don't have co-pilots. They don't have navigators. Not really needed, not really necessary, but overall a very interesting track, and I was explaining the track to Katie earlier. It starts big and then it tightens up. Because you got that big turn
wide.
One, two, and then it tightens up, and then you got that turn five, that little kink coming to that joker lap. It's going to get treacherous when it comes to more cars on track.
Before we had the snowfall, it was really sheet fresh ice, like it was like a mirror. And what happens is the studs dig into that really nicely, really hard. And so what we were figuring is that online, where the braking zone was going to cut up with the studs, you might actually find that, say, inside offline, the grip levels are up. So if it's super slippery, you might have been able to dive up the inside and go in. Now, the snowfall has kind of evened that out a little bit, and it remains to be seen what happens as the track develops, because, again, we've never done this before.
Yeah, exactly. All right, well, we're talking about the course, we're talking about the track, and we'll throw it down to the pits once again with Katie.
Well, and I'll talk about the drivers who just left the track. It's Kevin Erickson and Andreas Backerud. Andreas sitting second in the championship right now. I asked him what is his thoughts about Kevin Erickson going to battle. He said he's a stable driver. He's won loads. And honestly, if he could pick a teammate out of everybody, he said he'd pick Kevin Erickson because he can fix a car when he crashes it. Interesting thoughts, huh?
Yeah, great perspective there. Just the insight on that Kevin has, and you know, he missed a race. And Coley brought up a great point. We're talking about championships, and you can drop your basically your worst your worst finish of the season. And Kevin Erickson, we did not see him. He had a very unfortunate event and circumstance with, you know, getting hit by the vehicle. So that was definitely a bummer there. But
He admitted it on social media. You know, there was a family incident there, and they were working so super late to get all the cars ready. And he missed a round. But that's going to put him a little bit closer in terms of the championship points. Jared, look at the grid here. So we're looking at the Canadian Rally class. We'll talk to you a bit more about the spec of the cars, but the outside line's kind of high and flat. The inside line is low and sloped.
Slight bank.
But we've seen in Group E that lower line was a little bit quicker. The nitro lights are coming on in the background now. We're about to get this Canadian Rally class underway. This is the four-wheel drive class.
What's that say in French?
I'm not sure. Right, we did some translating earlier. Inside line again, Jared. Now, admittedly, that spec of car is higher than the Group N car, which was on the outside. This is open class for Canadian Rally. So we have our Canadian Rally champion taking part here. We've got two Mayos out on track. It's father and son. The son is the Canadian Rally champion, and they're in some pretty spec cars, either flat four or the Subaru down the back straight. 2.5 litre, 34mm restrictor, turbocharged, as you would expect from the Subaru flat four and sequential. Sequential gearboxes in three out of these four vehicles.
Yeah, essentially stage rally cars that have been adapted to, you know, doing this tighter, more short course stuff. And I think it's really cool. And we'll see in two-wheel drive drift cars out there. So everybody's saying, you know what? If I got an opportunity to drive at Trois-Rivières real quick, I know you're going to point out that cone there.
Yep.
So I know you will. So just let me talk.
No, carry on, mate. Yeah.
So basically adaptation, taking your driving skill. If I could drive Trois-Rivières next to Travis Pastrana, okay, hold my beer. Let's go. Let's have a good time.
Oh, they're up.
What's the cone about?
No, they're up for it. The other thing is, Jared, of course, they've actually got a rally in 3 weeks' time. So none of these. They're going to be a little bit more careful. Rally cross drivers tend to be a little bit more, how should we say, assertive in terms of cornering and passing.
Assertive.
Whereas rally drivers, these guys will probably look after the car a bit more, simply because they're doing the first or an early round of the Canadian Rally Championship literally in 3 weeks' time. But yeah, the cones. So you might be wondering why the cones are out there. That is to keep the support categories off the apexes. This is all about preserving the ice. I say it's first time we've done this, so you have to understand everybody's trying to get done. Here it is. So you push them a little bit wide, and that stops them chewing the apex up too much. Now, what Mayo did out in front was basically nailed a bunch of cones in the left-hander that's inside the Joker lap. Normally that would be an immediate penalty. I think if you just brushed it, they'd let you off, but he mowed them down.
He punted it.
Yeah,
he punted it. The lace is out.
I wonder. There are no messages on the timing screen yet. I mean, maybe we'll just let the Canadian Rally guys get on with it, Jared. But
yeah, I would have to think just with this class, you know, we're not splitting hairs here. This is a good supporter series. It's good to see the variety of cars because, again, here's your combustion engines. By no means are these supercars of what we saw last year, the Subarus. But, you know, this is a feeder series, and it's really good to celebrate and see, hey, this is something, you know, that's attainable. You know, this seems fun. So if this class grows more, maybe we can see more cars. As we see the 54 there, it looks like that is
the other Mayo.
Yeah, the other Mayo here with Jay Mayo, and that being Joel. So Joel Mayo coming to a halt there on course. So it looks like Mayo.
Yeah, so Joel is the dad in the 54.
And Jerome is the son
in 25. So Jerome out front is the Canadian Rally Champion, reigning Canadian Rally Champion. We were joking earlier, weren't we, Jared, about how are they going to do without their co-drivers? You know, I'm surprised you don't see more rally drivers take their co-driver as a spotter. But the thing is, the skill of a spotter is quite unique. But I think a familiar voice in your ear might be quite cool. If I were a rally co-driver and my driver was eyeing up Rallycross, I might be thinking, I better watch some old Rallycross races.
Look at that, Mayo, airing it out. He's out front, I mean, with a 9-second lead. And look at the snow roost coming off the back here. He's about to get, you know, again, keep in mind, this is just a semi-final. We will have a final, but a great run there from Mayo.
Yeah, four cars in each of these categories. We've got two-wheel drive category as well, which you might see a bit of. And they'll all go through. But so they race in a heat race to decide the grid for the semi. They then race in the semi to decide the grid for the final. So to be honest with you, I was 6 seconds up the road, unless they give him a couple of seconds per cone. And I don't think they will, to be honest. He's going to check a flag for him. And the Canadian Rally Champion, Jerome Mayo, is going to be on pole.
It didn't seem flagrant. It didn't seem flagrant, like just cutting corners.
You know,
like, it's not the Lewis Max Verstappen, you know, cutting corner heard around the world. It's more of a like, hey, he's just having fun out there.
So. Moreau in P2 is the driver that Mayo's team expected to challenge for the win. So Mayo, I think, with a pretty strong win at 6.4 seconds up the road. They were saying that Morissette and the other Mayo were here really to have some fun. In fact, you can see there the roll damage from earlier on today.
On his roof.
Yeah, we were watching, weren't we, and just went over. So,
Do you know the tires and the equipment they're running?
Yes,
I do. Are they running studded, or are they running kind of a traditional stage rally tire?
They're running a traditional stage rally tire from a manufacturer. They're all running the same one.
Right.
But it is the same tire you'd expect to see drivers use, style of tire you'd expect to see on Rally Sweden and on events where you're allowed a studded tire. ARA doesn't normally allow studded tires, but of course these guys are Canadian Rally Championship, and I think the studs are a bit more up here. They're more used to the snow.
There we go. All right, so not seeing any repercussions of hitting those cones. So congrats to Jerome Mayo, Alex Moreau, David Marcet, and Joel Mayo coming on in the rear. And here we go. We are going racing. Up next will be Group E, as our four-wheel drive vehicles are pulling off our feeder series. We're going to get to our all-electric bracket battles. We have our eight drivers staged and ready to go. We saw one battle previously. That was Connor Martel and Ollie Bennett. Ollie Bennett came out on top. So first up, we'll be seeing Robin Larson, who's our fastest in practice. Robin Larson will be going against Ollie Bennett. And then we'll be seeing Kevin Erickson versus Andreas Backerud, Frazier McConnell versus Chris Meek, and then finally, Ollie Erickson versus TP199, Travis Pastrana. How does the rest of the day work here as far as bracket battles, the road to the finish line?
Yeah, so from each of these quarterfinals, one driver will progress. That puts four into the semis. Then we get two through to the final. The winner of that final will be the top qualifier for the first time ever on snow and ice using these studded tyres. And I have to say, I'd want to be making it through to the semis, Jared. If you want a good result tomorrow, I think it's going to be tricky. If there's a bit of snow roost about, you get the drivers all want to be up as far as they possibly can.
All right, the A-Shock Energy road to the finish line. We are riding in the cockpit. Looks like Larson on the left, and I believe
Bennett.
That should be, is that Bennett? Yeah, that is. Thank you. So that is Ollie Bennett on the right. The cameras are outfitted. And I'll tell you what, Robin Larson from last year to this year, he seems like a different driver. His equipment, I think he's really enjoying the spec class of it all. It's really showing his driving prowess.
I think it's showing his class. Yeah. The supercars last year, he didn't have quite the same equipment as the Subaru factory drivers did. You know, the Audi is still a very accomplished car, but it wasn't adapted quite so quickly to the big tracks. Let's call them the big tracks of Nitro Rallycross. Now they're in a spec category car. Yeah, he took that first win at Lyddon Hill, Jared, and really honestly, he's been in incredible form ever since. One time not in on the podium. Yeah, we're not even talking one final miss. We're talking one time not on the podium.
Right.
That kind of consistency and speed when everybody has the same machinery is very impressive.
Yep, he's ready to cut it down. Even himself, you know, he had that half saw, almost cut himself through the neck.
Don't.
I had to reference it, man.
Such a so great success. Scary.
It was absolutely scary. So we are getting ready to do our bracket battle here. Ollie Bennett and Robin Larson.
So Larson, as the fastest driver in time practice earlier, gets to choose his grid position here. Remember, the pole man, the faster of the qualifiers, gets to choose which side they go. Note that he's gone low. So he's gone on the right-hand side of your screen, the left-hand side of the grid if you're sitting in the car. That's where Bennett went, and he won the start against Martel Jarrett. So we're keeping a close eye here on which side of the grid produces the best start. And for the other races coming up, Kevin Erickson, Frazier McConnell, and Oliver Erickson will be the drivers who get to choose that grid position. So just how critical is that?
Yeah, I think that's going to play a major role, as we just saw in the one and only Ollie Bennett and Connor Martel. So taking that lower line, maybe roosting your partner or your competitor and getting the snow in their face, and watch how they get out of the hole, how they're going to launch, how they're going to send it out of the gate. You know, and we talked about Kevin Erickson on the first maiden voyage of hitting the ice, hitting the snow. He dropped the clutch metaphorically, but just hammered down in the all electric vehicle, and it created a sandblaster or snowblaster machine out back. So I'm interested to see how they roll out, and especially with Larson having the fastest time so far.
Yeah, Kevin Erickson was saying to me, you don't want any wheel spin. So normally you have a degree of wheel spin. You don't want the car to bog. You know, if you've gone too low on the settings, obviously it's different settings with electric than it was with turbo internal combustion. So you have these different settings, which are actually displayed up on the dash there, and that gives you your launch away. But you don't want to get any wheel spin. If you do, you have to come out of the throttle, let the car almost get the spikes back in the ground and go again.
And here we go. We are ready to send it for our first battle here in the Great Eight. Robin Larson, number four, our current points leader, going against Ollie Bennett, who just fought to get into this position. Robin Larson in that DRR JC Dreyer Reinbold Racing JC RX Cartel leading the pack with Andreas Backrud sitting in second. 32nd card is up. Ollie Bennett, Excite, Focus Energy, My Energy, number 42. Who's coming out on top? You see that KB Forever stickers on the vehicles on the side. Nitro Rallycross announcing that they are retiring the 43 number in Nitro Rallycross and the championship. Here we go. Who's going to get the whole shot? Who's coming out on top? Let's send it for our first battle. NITRO, let's go. Robin Larson comes out of the gate. You see him roll out of it. Now, Ollie Bennett, look, he is wheel to wheel. And you don't want to go wheel to wheel. Ollie Bennett pushes away on the inside. Robin Larson pushes back. Ollie Bennett says no. Look at that. You're shutting the door. Look at carbon fiber wheel to wheel. And with all those 300 treads on those Yokohama tires, you do not want to see tread versus tread. Man, coming out of the gate, that was a brutal one.
Far too much wheel spin on the inside, Jared. You could see immediately that Larson got on the gas. Basically, the all four wheels lit up. Oh, Bennett gets nudged out in the wall.
Was he nudged out or he get nudged back?
Bit of contact.
Yeah. I mean, we were inside Ollie Bennett's car. You saw him kind of nose in. I want to go kind of the high and wide and see what really transpired. You got to keep in mind, guys, this is just bracket battles, the first one at 8. You got to go to semifinals, you got to go to finals, and you got to go to the finals tomorrow.
I loved seeing Bennett try to go around the outside. Of course, the problem with going around the outside in turn one is you're on the outside of the straight. You then got to go around the outside again in turn two. So it's a long, long way to make that play come off. But Bennett nearly got enough with the slightly slower start. That doesn't make any sense when you say it like that, but without the wheel spin is what we mean. So you can dial into these cars,
exactly.
Jared.
Dialing the knobs. And Travis talks about that when he was up here and joined us a long time. He was talking about dialing in and what the numbers are, what's the proper setting so you don't fully torque the thing out. You have that nice modern horsepower and get out of the hole smoothly.
Yeah, let's just give you a couple of basic ones. So you can choose what gear you want to start in, two, or three. Some of the drivers are saying they're going to start in third gear because they don't want the wheel spin. Then you've got settings 1 to 10. There's a bunch of those, but let's go with simple. It's how quickly the power comes in. As Larson comes out the Joker, miles in front of him. We know Bennett has unfortunately been in the wall, so might as well take the chance to talk you through it a bit. And you've got to get those settings right. You want the car to roll away, but you don't want it to roll and bog too much. It's very clever. Basically, you can limit the power up to 60 kilometers an hour, so that's kind of, I don't know, 40 miles an hour-ish, or 35 miles an hour. At that point, then, you unleash the full 1,000 horsepower. So you can put a different map in it, just like with an internal combustion car. How quickly does the throttle come in? What does the curve of that throttle look like? How does it respond compared to your throttle pedals? It's clever stuff. I say, they're all still learning about it, even on tar and dirt.
Yeah. No, I mean, we've had dirt starts. We've had tarmac starts. We've had, absolutely paved starts. And now it's snow start. There's the checkered flag. You can see it was 16 seconds, 29 seconds.
It doubled on the last lap.
Yeah, when he went to that wall there, and you can see a little bit of flapping. I'd love to see the high and wide between Ollie Bennett and Larson, but you can see Bennett there.
Look at his steering angle, Jared. He's going in a straight line, but he's got 90%, 90 degrees of steering to the right. So here he is. So he's trying to come around the outside. What happens? He has just a little touch, maybe rear right on Larson to front left on Bennett. Do you see here?
Yep.
It's nothing,
he got
really
squirrely.
Yeah, boom.
I mean, Ollie looked like he was going in, and watch, he nudges him, and it just pushes him outside. I think he stood on the brakes probably and just threw him right into the bank. Robin Larson continues his success. He gets the victory and will advance on the fastest in practice. And he goes against Ollie Bennett, who have already fought against Connor Martel. Unfortunately, finds his way into the bank. And I'm not talking about the cash money bank. I'm talking about the snow bank. So he's basically cashing his FC1X.
People talk about robbing the bank. Unfortunately, the bank robbed Ollie there.
Robin robbed him.
Well, yeah,
robbed going into the bank. And then, okay.
There's a bunch of puns.
Leave the dad jokes to me, okay? All right, so Robin Larson will continue on. He moves on to the semifinals. We'll see who he goes against. Will it be either Kevin Erickson or his teammate Andreas Backrud, another DRR JC vehicle, or Mr. Kevin Erickson, who, again, unfortunately, we did not see him at round one or two, but then eventually we saw him, and he is definitely a pilot one to watch. I think he is a threat if the vehicle's up to snuff and he's feeling good. I think Erickson could twist the screws on old Andreas Backrud Snackerud.
Yeah, absolutely. Either of the Ericssons can get it done. Can't say Ollie has taken two TQs, hasn't quite managed to convert that so far.
Backrud. That's Backrud, the 13.
Yes, it is.
That is Andreas Backrud, the 13. Snackerud saw him just last week at Ken Block's Celebration of Life, had some great words. There's Kevin Erickson, who's still hobbling around a little bit from his accident.
Yeah, I saw that.
He doesn't have his crutch, but he's saying just with the cold weather has to hamper that. And he even did fall on the ice because both him and his brother are wearing Jordans around here. I said, dude, I get it. You're from Sweden. Doesn't mean you can walk on snow and walk on water, frozen water that is. Slipped and hurt himself even a little bit more.
This is what you need.
Yeah.
Yeah? These are the bad boys. Yeah. It's not cold. We don't care. Yeah. That's a studded.
That's
like,
as simple as it is.
Rubber thing that you just chuck over your normal shoes. There was a brilliant Instagram story from Kevin at the top of the banking, and Ollie was just going. Like arms like this, literally, he slid the whole way down the bank into the bottom, and then was stuck at the bottom, and literally couldn't come back up. It was sheet ice, so great stuff. Yeah, you've got to have studs in your shoes. These guys have got to have studs on there, and going to see who gets away quickest. Is it going to be that inside line again?
Well, you know what they call that when you start slipping, right? You go like this, or you go off snowboard jump. That's called rolling up the windows.
So you start
rolling up the windows, and then it just went straight down.
It was so good, dude. Yeah. All the way down to the bottom.
All right, so here we go. There are the drivers, one from Norway, one from Sweden. Andreas Backerud, DRR, JC, RX Cartel vehicle, the number 13, going against Kevin Erickson. He's got the number of Jordan, number 23, hence probably the shoes, hence the kicks. And here we go. So Kevin Erickson chooses that inside line, like we saw for Robin Larson. I wouldn't say it ended eventually. Eventually paid off for him because, you know, Ollie, I would say, kind of took himself out in that scenario. But we are just moments away to seeing these guys send it. There we go. Look at Backerud spin him, but gets way out ahead of Kevin Erickson. Now he dives in. Wow, Backerud, a great start.
So Backerud has the advantage of having had Larson go just before him. His teammate has been out there and will almost certainly have been on the radio and said, dude, 10 was way too much. Go 7, whatever it was they chose. He was on the outside line, but he made it work where Bennett couldn't quite make it work. Got to turn one first. That's the first time we've seen the outside line work. That's cool for me, because that now means other people are going to be going, oh, man, which side of the grid should we be on? I didn't want a situation where maybe only one side of the grid worked, and I think it's proved that it's as much about start settings as it is about grid position.
Look at how much powder is being thrown up around those apexes of those turns, especially there coming into that one corner right before. We're talking about that number 4. That gets really tight. You see how thick that snow is? That's going to slow you down because, you know, you got to think about the sidewall of the tire, the snow getting in the wheels, the snow getting in the side of the door. That's going to slow them down quite a bit, and that's going to bunch up a lot of drivers, especially when you see more than two.
You're seeing Backerud speed on his wheel there. When we were on board with him, you could actually read the speeds. Obviously, it's not always accurate because with the wheel spin, you don't necessarily get an accurate reading. And I must say, it's in kilometers an hour. So here we go. Look, through the long right-hander onto the straight now. 120, 130, 140, 150 at the end of the straight. Now, yesterday it was 177. So that gives you an idea of how the grip level has come down a bit in the banking on turn one, which leads up. Watch through here. This is turn three where it tightens in. Oh, over the crest, hits the wall on the inside. But holding on tight, he's got to nail this because Kevin Erickson behind 4.1 should be enough. But he's got to get his joker right.
And what's also really interesting here is look at Backerud goes into the Yokohama Tire joker lap. Can Kevin Erickson get him? No, it looks like, Andreas Backerud narrowly gets him by a car length. And we saw Backerud when he was going, watch that big turn number one. He was fighting that wheel. You think in the dirt, kind of just set it and forget it like you're drifting. No, the car's going to kick back because you got ruts. You have all the different kind of elevation changes of that snow. Look at Kevin Erickson's not giving up. He's going to try to get him in one more corner because, again, finish line's on that far side. There's still some track left.
Trying to come all the way around the outside. Those ruts are building up, Jared, you're right, and there will be a point at which the drivers have to stay in there, but Backerud going to come through that long left-hander, take the checker flag. Despite Ericsson's purple sectors on the last lap, it wasn't enough to close him down. Joker lap, 3.2 seconds. We've seen twice now is the difference between them. So that's the number to keep
the
in your head, whether or not it's enough. Yeah, the delta. Nice
delta,
done.
Baby.
Yeah, nice. Yep.
All right, Andreas Backerud looks like he gets the victory, comes out on top, and look at that little fist pump. From the boy in blue.
Next opponent is teammate, RX Cartel. They'll be annoyed about that. I mean, obviously, they would have known looking at this if they both got the result that they were going to come up against each other.
They'd rather go against each other than not, I guess, is the case. But here it is, that Yokohama Tire Joker lap. As you said, 3.2 seconds on that delta. So Kevin Erickson would have been, had it been 3.3 seconds in order to get in front of Andreas Backerud. Not the case.
Yeah, and he went in basically 3.9 back, and he came out 0.6 back. So we know that's around the 3.2. And I say, Bennett, when it was the same with Martel, that was the exact same difference.
It's a beautiful evening here. It's Friday night. Act like it. here at Trois-Rivieres. And as we are up in the booth, let's throw it down to Katie. Katie, what's cooking?
We have another great battle up ahead, Fraz McConnell and Chris Meek. Now, I was talking to Fraz about his thoughts regarding going up against Chris. Now, he said he is a rally legend. And he said, get this, I have been following him since I was a kid, but tonight I'm going to be finishing ahead of him. And I was like, that's some solid confidence right there. And he said, well, which is great, of course. But one thing, gentlemen, that he did mention, he said, Chris is committed. That's the word he'd like to use for him as a driver. Do you agree or disagree with Fraz on his thoughts of Chris Meek?
Oh, I mean, we could. What's the one clip of Chris Meek that's absolutely legendary that everybody references?
Oh, mate.
The finish rally, right?
Rally Finn. So he won Rally Finland, the fastest rally in the World Rally Championship with the fastest ever average speed time. Incredible. Yeah, Katie, he's super quick. I think the reference point there is probably the fact that Chris doesn't come from that door-to-door world, and yet he's got stuck right in. Him and Travis have got those big magnets that brings them together, and I think the fact is that Fraser knows Chris, just because he isn't that experienced in rallycross, isn't going to give it up in turn one. We saw it in Lyddon Hill. We saw it in Sweden. We saw it at Phoenix, didn't we, when he made that pass? And he's still convinced that the pass was good and the stewards are wrong. Been very magnanimous about it. But, yeah, he will get stuck in if he gets the chance.
30 seconds to go, and we will get that start. Some great insight there from Katie Osborne down in the pits. Fraser McConnell says, I admire you, but guess what? I'm going to beat you. With all respect due, I'm going to smoke you, Chris Meek. Chris Meek in that excite energy, number 62, Fraser McConnell, DRR, doing it for the R, doing it for Uncle Sol. And again, that green, yellow, and black, the cool runnings. I mean, all the jokes aside, Fraser McConnell is no joke. This kid is coming to win. And, picking up A-Shock Energy as a sponsor, you can see Jamaica on the car. He's been a busy boy, and his mom and dad are here in the building. He's got a lot of supporters, so he's got a lot of people on his side. Look at that. You see the car getting squirrely, getting sideways. Fraser McConnell, maybe about a car length. Yeah, look at that. He gets out in front of Chris Meek, but now his racecraft needs to get tight and right.
Yeah, so if anybody can do the lap time, Chris can. And Chris said to me yesterday, he said, you know what? He said, coming into this, I was never worried about whether or not I would be able to do the lap time. And that's because we're just saying he's one of the best rally drivers in the world. He knows how to do a good lap time. And if you had to put your money on a driver on first lap or in changing conditions or with something tricky, I would personally always bet on a rally driver over a racer. But the racecraft side of things is a bit trickier. Now, if he can get close enough, he's going to joker immediately. Here he goes in now. But now he's got to take out a chunk of time. It was 1.5 going in, Jared.
That's
so coming
big.
Out, it's going to be massive. And to be honest with you, I don't think Fraser will make enough mistakes. Look at the ruts now. You can see the ruts in turn 7 on board with McConnell coming up. And then watch for his brakes here. What does he do with the wheel on the brakes at 100 kilometres an hour, 60 miles an hour? Little nip on the bar, the handbrake in the middle, get the rotation on. He's so patient on the throttle. Look, open the steering up, several inputs.
Yeah, really well done there. Seems very patient. He doesn't seem kind of chaotic, behind the wheel. It doesn't matter if it's dirt or whatever. Look at the
Speed.
Attitude of the vehicle. Really well done. Very fast. You saw a little bit of feedback there. The wheel kicked out or the car kicked out. You got to combat that, and he keeps it really tight.
So 5.6 seconds. We know the Joker Delta's about 3.2. It's gone on to 6.8. I think
That's
Chris
massive.
Has got a problem. So Chris, I'm pretty sure, has got a problem because Fraz is a great driver, but he's not taking that amount of time out of him in per sector. So Fraz, he's going purple, so he's doing fastest sectors. But remember, that's just against Chris on this one. You can see Chris coming in now into turn 4, and Fraz is already out of the joke lap.
He's
going up.
There's no way.
No.
So, basically, Chris Meek is hoping that Fraz has some sort of hiccup or has something wrong with his vehicle. We know that Chris Meek had a transmission issue earlier. His team worked feverishly to get the car back out there. As good a Chris Meek is a rally racer, unfortunately, just falls back a little bit, right out of the gate. So Fraser McConnell never looked back from that start line. And that A-Shock Energy Jamaican driver, he's going to take it to the yard all the way. And again, Fraser McConnell, the 35. Mom and dad are here in Canada cheering him on. His first ever ice race just last weekend in Finland, getting some seat time on the ice, on the snow. It looks like it paid off a little bit. And a lot of bit, as you can see Chris Meek crawling in.
Yeah,
so you
definitely.
Wonder if there was an issue or just kind of, all right, I'm going to crawl it in just because he knows
I think he'd want to feel the grip levels, Jared. I think that's the thing is if Chris had a healthy car, I think he'd be out there trying hard anyway to get, that more crucial seat time ahead. Fraz will be pleased with that. You say, he's got a lot of respect for Chris. I think a lot of the other drivers are suddenly realizing as well that, you know, if Chris gets out front, he's going to be very, very hard to beat if he's got a healthy car under him. The team, shout out to the mechanics at XI Energy Racing, because they were working so hard. There were people going, 6 mil spanner, get me this. Is the drive shaft in the subframe? They worked so hard to get Chris out. And they'll be gutted, you know, after he did a decent job in time practice. Literally, he made it to the grid with a few seconds to spare. So hats off to them. They'll have a little re-prep overnight, get the car ready for tomorrow. And he's just going to have to work a little bit harder in those races tomorrow to make it through to a decent grid position.
And that's another thing, just thinking about the equipment. You know, when you're seeing these cars pull into the pits, you see all hands on deck. They're prying off wood chips. They're prying off snow. And their hands are cold. But guess what, Katie, what's going on?
We were talking to Robin Larson earlier about the strategy for today, which was playing it a bit safe, but making sure you make your mark for tomorrow. How well do you think you accomplished that in that first heat?
Yeah, pretty good. And the start was not the best, but I could still hold my inside against Bennett. So, yeah, we'll see what we can do on the starts. But I think it's me against Packard now in the semifinal. So. Yeah, of course, you want to go as far as possible on the first day, but yeah, we'll see.
A little teammate action, a little 1-2 in the championship action, guys. We have our hands full with the Dry Rival team here tonight.
Yeah, and he's such a soft-spoken dude when he's on camera, but off camera, he's got such a big personality. He's really fun to be around, and it's great to see how competitive he truly is. Here we go, 30 seconds ago, you could see that KB livery. That's retro Ken Block livery, KB forever, hashtag KB43VER. And we have a great piece talking about Ken in throughout this weekend. He's going against Ollie Erickson, so, and I know you had some great interviews there. Talking with a lot of drivers, and we'll get into that.
Yeah, you'll see that. You should see that tomorrow. We've been talking to the drivers about their memories of a great guy, Ken Block, and that livery was one of the first. Yeah, but rally cars didn't look like that, Jared. They were traditional. You don't hit the sticker, goes here. This is where the tire stick goes. Ken turns up. Pastrana going to come down. Pastrana loses his start.
Ollie gets sideways.
Oh, around the outside.
Oh, look at this. Ollie Erickson gets into the bank. He does fight it off. Travis Pastrana gets out front. And look at Ollie Erickson, he fights his way up front. He was talking about, you know, the ice, the conditions, what's going on. And here they are, you know, here we are a few battles deep. So the conditions are ever changing. Look at that. You see Ken Block kind of maybe get a little bit wide, throw his elbows out, maybe check up Ollie Erickson there. Because he knows how talented Ollie Erickson, how fast he is. But Ken, or excuse me, I was going to say Ken Block is giving that livery.
It's the livery.
Travis Pastrana.
That's what we were talking about, Jared. This was the first time. It was a DC Shoes livery, which, of course, Ken was the company that he founded. Yeah, in 2005, I think it was, and in ARA. And everyone's like, you can't have a camo livery.
Whoa.
Oh, Pastrana runs into the bank on the outside. This has been the untidiest run from both. He's only got to bring it home in front. But... dude, how cool is the livery? Like, that's what Ken did. He came in and go, well, I'm not doing it like that. Those liveries suck. I want the cool one. And that's what Travis is running the tribute for. And it's cool to see it back out, especially a snow camo livery on the first ever snow event.
It's very fitting.
It's really cool. It's super cool.
Very fitting and very honorary of Travis Pastrana to run that livery. And he ran that same livery on his Gumball 3000 car. And, so many memories. And Travis, look at windshields are broken here as we're riding with the number 199. He's going for it. Talking about Fraz and how calm he was. But look at Travis was trying to tighten it up. Look at how much snow is accumulated there. It's all chopped up over the hip. That thing bucks over. Now, Travis, look at that. Look at the wheel.
Oh, two sideways, Jared. Taps the bank, puts the nose in. Pastrana's gone
round. And he has gone on the bank.
Where's Erickson? Goes up the inside. Pastrana facing the wrong way. Came out too hard. The rear left tapped the bank. That flung the car around the other way. And Pastrana is going to go no further from the looks of things.
And it looks like Ollie Erickson got a bit of good luck there. Bad luck for Pastrana. We're going to have to get that high and wide. What went wrong? As you said, got squirrely, kind of wound up. And then you saw his hands go in. And there it is, the face of defeat, unfortunately, for Pastrana. He did lose his power steering in practice earlier. So you wonder if that showed up once again. That's going to be hard with those tight corners. And you're fighting. And he's sprained his thumb a couple times this season already, early on. And I mean, that gentleman has more broken bodies than we actually are broken bones, and I actually have bones in my body.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that gentleman has endured a lot, absolute legend, but he always wants to win. But right now, not the case. Unfortunately, he goes into the bank, going to that Yokohama Tire Joker lap. Ollie Erickson will advance on in that Olsberg's vehicle, the Red Bull helmet. He'll be going against Fraser McConnell in the semis. So Pastrana, you see just no dialogue.
Oh yeah, without a doubt. Hang on. I just didn't know where else to go here. I tried to get back on the track, but all I saw was nothing.
So he couldn't.
Yeah, they're coming for you. They'll pull you out.
Okay, he couldn't see where to go back on the track. So basically, he's I couldn't see anything. That's what we're talking about, the contrast. You can't see it, and he ended up off in the deep slow. So Pastrana is out of the battles. Yeah, it's a shame, man.
Yeah, unfortunate turn of events and a turn four. Travis Pastrana, he'll be back tomorrow, but unfortunately his day is done. Will not be getting that TQ. We talked about it earlier. You know, he's in that fifth position in the championship. He is your defending Nitro Rallycross champion. You know, had the supercars, the debut of the FC1X this season. Unfortunately, not working out here. We'll pull him out. Thumbs up there. So it looks like our quarterfinals are done. We have four drivers. Larson, Backerud, Fraser McConnell, and Ollie Erickson are in the semifinals. And this is how things are shaping up so far. Travis Pastrana is out. Moving on, Robin Larson will go against his DRR JC RX Cartel teammate of Andreas Backerud. And then Fraser McConnell is also up in the mix of championship talks. He goes against Ollie Erickson from Sweden, who helped develop this very one, FC1X. There is your A-Shock Energy Nitro Rallycross Road to the Finish Line. A-Shock, a modern performance energy drink created for today's active generation. Yokohama Tire, make every drive a performance. My Energy, driving the charge to a sustainable future. And here we are taking a look at this course. And we are pulling Travis Pastrana off. He went off course, but right now it looks like we are going to be seeing side-by-side LCQ. Let's take a look at some highlights. Wow, oof. Yanking out that FC1X.
Whoa, steady on, lads. He's already put it through the snowbank. You don't want any more. Right, this is Travis in turn one that comes around the outside, just squeezes Erickson to the inside line. Pastrana now's got it. Watch the brake lights coming on and off. They're both trying to get the rotation in the car. So at this point, we're all good. It's a bit later in the race. Here he is, like, squeezes Erickson. Fair enough, you know, he's half a car length in front. Erickson will probably say, he would have said he wasn't happy, but as he's gone through, you know, he'll be fine. But we were on board, weren't we, Jared, when Travis had his moment. I think it's an over-rotation. There might be, look, so he's running the back left here. Was there an issue already? You mentioned about the power steering, which had happened earlier on when he went over the jump. He's got a bit of right lock on there. Look, just manages to keep it out of the bank. The problem with the banks is you can lean on them a bit, but imagine the point at which it collapses. Here we go. He's really sideways. Now he gets on the throttle.
Powers back.
Now he gets sucked into the bank on the right. Oh, look at the marshal running for it. Yeah, a bit too close there, guys. Stand back a bit. Tries to spin the car around and can't get back through. So we were on board and you couldn't see. Basically, he didn't hit the bank on the outside. Tank slapper. And then right wheel goes in and gets sucked into the bank. The bank isn't hard enough to lean on like in Rally Sweden. Yeah. You can lean on it a bit, but you push through that sort of hard coating on the outside and it'll just suck you in.
Yeah. Unfortunate turn of events there for Travis Pastrana. And, you know, sometimes he joins us up here. He had a smile on his face going
in. I'm sure.
No, I mean, yes. I mean, he always wants to engage. And also, he's going to look at the rest of the competition. He's always working. Even though he might not be in the bracket battles, he's still going to see how the competition's shaping up.
Yeah. You know, he knows this is the place with all the footage. We've got the big screen. You know, we know what's going down. So, yeah, not ideal. So, tricky conditions. The ruts are building up a bit. There's a bit of loose snow out there. The banks aren't quite firm enough to lean on. And, you know, we've seen people getting squeezed into the banks on that occasion. Travis went just a bit too far. And Chris Meek's car getting a little re-prep. He's out already, so that's ready for tomorrow. And getting ready for semi-finals in a bit.
Next up, we will be seeing side-by-side LCQ. We have a variety of pilots in that class and a variety of manufacturers, so that should be pretty exciting to see. And a few vehicles parked to the side. Only four in, so five are pushed to the side until tomorrow. Let's see how that transpires. All right, so as we are in the pits and taking a look, Katie's staying up with all the biz. What are you hearing down there, Katie?
Yeah, you're getting a real good look at Ollie Erickson's car, and while you're getting a look at it too, Ollie's getting his hands under there. From your point of view, is it cosmetic or is there greater damage?
For me, it's all cosmetic. You know, it was a tough turn one. I thought I had pretty good launch. The ice on the inside wasn't that good. We have to pick in the pre-grids. I didn't have a chance to look at it, but if I would have seen it, I would have taken start position two for sure. But I had a good run into turn one. I felt I had a good start. He was not ahead of me or anything, and yeah, then he just came in, turned in on me. I hit the snowbank quite a lot, thought I would roll. But he probably didn't see me either. So, yeah, he got ahead of me there. I bumped him a bit into turn two. He braked. I wasn't ready for his braking point. So, sorry to the Vermont guys for that. But, from there, I just tried to chase him. Tried to force some mistakes. And, it's not easy to force mistake from Travis. But eventually that happened. So, too bad we couldn't race it to the end. But, good race.
Yeah, more racing for Ollie Erickson here to come, guys.
Thank you so much. Some great insight there from Ollie Erickson. You know, even just getting into that tussle, some carbon fiber on carbon fiber, Ollie Erickson came out on top, both of them just hitting the banks. And, you know, it sounded like he wasn't really exactly excited about the turn one, but not pointing fingers, just it's new territory.
Interesting to see what he said. Do you remember what he said about the start positions on the grid? You know, would I have chosen the other one? I think people are starting to look at it now and think, is the other lane going to be better? I kind of think if you're off the line and then coming downhill, there's a little bit of momentum going your way there. But we need to go down to have a little stand on the grid, Jared, ourselves, and have a look and see what the lie of the land is ahead of tomorrow.
And here we are, side-by-side LCQ. We have, you can see, five side-by-side machines. And here we are. Who's coming out on top? Who is going to the finals? We started out with quite a few.
Yeah, it's Villiard and Tiffault on the front row, and only five cars in this. There should be seven, so a couple have obviously retired for the evening. Two cars went through from the semi-final straight to the front row of the final, so Grégoire Michaud and the P2 guy from the semi-final have gone straight through, and then the remaining five of the seven, there's your seven listed up on the start, but I say only five of them have made it to the start line. They'll move up the inside, proving that it can be done. I think when we see more cars on track, Jared, you will see that a bit more. You've got to remember that with the battles, it's pretty easy to block one car. Yeah. The difference when you've got multiple cars is you go low to block the car and you go, ah, good, I've held the one guy off behind me. But the guy who's two cars back, gone out wide, coming in tight, going to get the exit speed, and you'll see a bit more passing, which is what we're seeing with side-by-side here. Someone's just realised the cones are there. Oh, damn it, the cones are there. They're turning back out again.
Right.
But great, another great support category. I'm super jealous that we just don't have enough space for things like side-by-sides in the UK. I might have to start some sort of campaign
with
my local MP.
So Villiard, I'll tell you what, Tuffaut is one to watch. He's currently sitting in third. Villiard out front, Morrison. Tuffaut is the only one that took the Yokohama Tire Joker lap.
Is Tuffaut the guy you mentioned does drift?
Yeah, Tuffaut
FD
does.
Or?
Tuffaut, I've seen him in Formula Drift, also DMCC, Formula Drift Canada. So, yeah, Jonathan Tuffaut, I've seen him, drift over the years, and also looking forward to the two-wheel drive class that's up next. So that's just four cars and should be really fun to watch. So Villiard out front, but has yet to hit that Yokohama Tire Joker lap. Keep in mind three laps here. You can see that Apex talking about 3.2, says gonna lose the position to Morrison, or is he going to gain? No, he won't
sure
gain.
Morrison to Tiffault. So Tiffault is joking from P3, and they're suggesting Morrison gonna lose. There's some cool liveries out there, Jared. I'm just looking there. Villiard's livery is pretty sick. Oh, a bit too sideways on the exit, but then gets the car flicked back the other way. Manages to avoid the cones. I think someone's hit that last cone and maybe run it out a bit wide. They're going to go joker. Not this time, so they're going to wait another lap.
All right, so Morrison goes for it. Tiffault looks like he might gain that position. If he mashes the throttle through here, might get it, but he gets into that bank. And there we go with Villiard out front, still continuing on. And it looked like Tiffault did not gain the position according to our scoring and timing, but right there nipping on the heels of him. So no, did not. You can see that out back. Morrison, oh no, Tiffault did get him. So Tiffault did get Morrison. And how many are moving on here?
Colin?
Everybody's going through from the LCQ, so in theory we could have had all nine cars through to the final, but we were a couple of cars down before. We lost another couple. Right. I get it. You know, don't forget some of these guys. I said the one lad I spoke to yesterday literally bought a side-by-side. He's in the snowmobile industry, bought a side-by-side from the same manufacturer, used it this summer. Someone invited him to come to GP3R for the summer race, which is a mixture of tarmac and dirt. They use the dirt section here in the horse trotting arena. He loved it so much, he came to me and he said, you know what? It's not, my car's totally standard. I'm not going to win. He said, but I love it and I want to get involved. He said, we got a phone call. Do you want to come and race at Nitro Rallycross in 2 weeks' time? And I said, yes. And yep. I think that's cool, man.
Heck yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, especially to race on this unique layout. What's going on? All right. See the...
Good battle going on in the background, yeah, right on the hairpin up at turn three. You can see, can't you, the two cars there coming into the dark area. Going to flick the car around to the right now. Looking up the inside again. Going to be a bit of contact inside. Not to, yeah, because of the cone out there on the line. These guys are 20 seconds back with their own personal fight.
Yep. Gets loose in the 18.
Gets up.
And that's Gosselin. Having some issues there, maybe not the right tire selection.
Well, the way that car's behaving, I'd suggest it's either only rear-wheel drive or something's gone wrong with the front drive. I don't know the spec of every car in here. We know that they're all very different, so, yeah.
All right, so Villiard started out front, looks like...
Justin Smash following him round. Look, you can't beat a bit of Smash. So we've got some other drone ops here with Justin as well, but it's look at that drone coming down the straight. VR takes the win from the drone, I think, there, Jared, by about 0.6 per second.
Gets him by a blade. So Villiard out front to Foe in second, Morrison in third. Tardif and Gosselin.
So, no, it does have front drive shafts, the 18. So it's got front shafts, meaning it is an all-wheel drive vehicle. You can see them in between the suspension. But it was pretty sideways, so I was just wondering if maybe it had some sort of an issue with the drive from the rear, across the rear engine through to the front. But looking at the angles here, no, I'd say not. Those strobe lights in the back, Jared, is that allowed? You know, if you're up close right behind a dude who's got basically a disco light in your face, is that a distraction technique, do you think?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. I think, like you said, it's more awareness than anything.
Yeah, true, yeah, more awareness. With the roost. You see it flashing away there. Look,
yeah, you
picture.
Can see that 18 just getting swirly from the start. But a great race there from Villiard. A battle for second between Tifoe and Morrison. That was a really good battle. I'm excited to see just all of them back out there again on this track. And just warming things up here on this very unique course, making history. Nitro Rallycross on the snow and the ice. And this is one of two rounds up here in the Great White North. And Trois-Rivieres, a great host to us. Thank you so much. And again, to the whole staff and all the crew. The lights are on here tonight. We'll finish before dinner time tomorrow, but Villiard comes out on top to Foe, Morrison, Gosselin, and Tardif. I saw Tardif back up actually there, so some issues right before the finish line. All right, so as we are shaping things up, we have semifinals for our Group E, but unfortunately somebody that's not joining them is with Katie now.
Yeah, as we were talking, Jared, you and I earlier about Travis Estrana, and let's take it back actually earlier today, your thumb. You kind of started a little rocky for you out here in Canada.
We were quickest in practice, felt really, really comfortable. This Vermont sports car team has done absolutely amazing, and unfortunately, power steering went out right before the jump, and just, it's okay. I dislocated my thumb earlier, actually twice, once in the first round and once again filming for Gymkhana, so it pops in a little easier, but we went out there and, so we qualified pretty far back. Actually got a good jump on that one. It was awesome back out in front, and I couldn't get out of second gear, so we did that whole lap in second. So all the straightaways, I've just started overdriving and panicking, trying to figure out how to shift, and we're trying to get a good send off for Ken. We've got the speed to win this thing. We just got to put it together tomorrow.
As it relates to Ken, there, could you say you're still having fun for him?
Have more fun to get it out there in front and give him a proper send-off this week. But I'm so proud of the team for really going. He built Vermont Sports Car, and he built the sport of rally. And, this one's just, it's for Lucy and Leah. Micah and his kids. It's just to be out here and to have that 43 on the side that can block forever. It means so much to me, and you know, I really want to do the best we can, you know, for everyone involved and to try to get this thing on top. So
for you and for Ken, guys, it's definitely an honor, as you can tell, that Travis is driving with him.
Yeah, just it bears repeating. We lost January 2nd, Ken Block, who left his mark on the world, not just in motorsports, but from just the evolution of his career and what he did professionally, but more so what he did. I had the pleasure, I'll just bring it in and just make it personal. I had the pleasure, me and my oldest son had the pleasure of going to his celebration of life in Park City last week, and Travis spoke some words and, you know, dear Dick, and it's not about who was there, but it's how important, how many people he touched, just emotionally, and it's crazy how many people are telling me, like, I didn't know how much he affected my life. And I'll just go out and say it. And Scotto, who founded Hoonigan with him, said, let's go on record and say Ken Block was kind of the most influential person in motorsports over the last 20 years. And think about that. That's a magnanimous, massive statement. But I will tell you, think about it. I'll let that one settle in, because Ken Block changed the landscape of what motorsports is and how it's done and what you do and how you do it. And I always say he didn't write chapters. He wrote books. He wrote books about his pre-DC life. He wrote DC Drawers and Dub and 8-Ball prior to that, sold that, got into motorsports. And Travis told a great story at his celebration of life. And Ken says, when his agent, he says, hey, I got dropped by Puma. I'll pick up DC if you introduce me to Vermont Sports Car. And that's how they really started their professional relationship. So sorry to kind of, you know, take over.
Not
that
at all.
Whole,
we're celebrating. Yeah, so. We're celebrating the life of a great guy. And we hope that you'll be able to hear some lovely stories from Jared, myself. We've been lucky enough to work in that sphere. But from my side, I've had so many messages from fans at home on Instagram and stuff, just about how sorry they were and how much Ken and he's the reason I watch Rallycross. He's the reason I watch this. And it's that reach. You know, it just goes down transatlantic, around the world, right down to new fans who maybe wouldn't even have had their eyes on motorsport were it not for Ken. And I just, really cool, man. Yeah. Really cool.
And also, as Ken was a member of the Nitro family and Rallycross, Nitro Rallycross has chosen to make the statement that they are officially retiring the number 43 from Nitro Rallycross. And again, this is a shout out to his family, our love and thoughts, and you know, it's just such a big thought towards obviously Lucy, Leah, Kira, and Micah, and their family and all their friends, because the family runs deep. So thank you, Ken, for all you did. Subaru, we continue the conversation about rally and Rallycross, and you know, you're seeing some old models, some new models, and this is all-wheel drive. So this is our four-wheel drive vehicles here, and we are intended to see two-wheel drive. That's what I was looking forward to next, but it looks like we might be bouncing around a little bit. And all right, so our four-wheel drive final is here.
So Jerome Mayo, Jared, has chosen to go on the outside. So by winning his semi-final, remember, there's only four cars in this, the four all-wheel drive cars, he gets to choose which side of the grid he goes. You're going to see this throughout the weekend in the different classes, and he's decided to take the high line. So he's left of your screen, he's right on the grid, and he feels that's the better place to be. We have seen some rocket ship starts from that side of the grid. Yeah. Can he get it done again here? The Nitro lights are there. They're just in behind our lovely big screen. There it is. You can just see the little red countdown has started. Yeah, it's Yoel Mayo on the outside. Go on, yeah, go on, go.
No, yours. I said yours.
Yoel Mayo on the outside. David Morissette on the inside of row one. On row two on the outside is Alex Moreau. And on the inside, Jerome Mayo. So, my apologies to French people. We do our best. And they're huge Rallycross fans, Jared. Rallycross in France is absolutely massive. Love to take you to an event there sometime. Like, the crowd is, they love this sport. We're in French Canada, and it's cool to see these guys going for it.
I don't remember if I told you the story. I grew up in San Diego, California. My mom grew up in Poitiers, France for a couple years. She says, take French. I failed French. So here we go. Let's go. Nitro, send it. Coming from the back. Look at this. Yeah. All right, is that the other Mayo?
It is. I think he's about
look
to stick
that.
It up the inside. This is father. Yeah, father up the inside of son. I think he's thought better of it. His son's the Canadian rally champion. Goes around the outside fully lit, carrying the speed through. Yeah. Dad is in P2.
So he's got up into second place. Three of these cars are run out of the same Canadian squad down the back straight. I love the sound of a flat four Subaru, I really do. Colin McRae, my hero, Richard Burns, you know, sadly those two.
Oh, no!
In the wall on the outside.
The 25, that is our leader, that's Mayo, but his pops coming and look, he's giving it a go. The father and son get into it, that back right corner of Joel Mayo getting into that bank. Unfortunate turn of events.
Subaru. These are all Subarus, Jared. We were just touching it. My heroes, McRae, Burns. Yeah, look, Petter Solberg, huge in the in-rally. Ken Block, Travis Pastrana, they've all been associated with this brilliant brand. Oh, another pass. So Mayo's got all sorts of problems. He's going backwards. But it's just the noise of a flat four. There's a Japanese magazine called Boxer Sound, which is about all about that noise. And they're just great bits of kit, you know.
All right, so the 25... Looks like he is. Is he still holding on to it? Looks like Joel Mayo still out front. And then again, Jerome Mayo sitting in third. So it looks like Joel still, surprisingly, is out front. So the Pops is sitting in third. Moreau sitting in second. So how that came to be is I'm very surprised. I did see Moreau get into the bank there, into that Joker lap. Now keep in mind, there are five laps in this all-wheel drive final.
So we're getting messages through, Jared. Fais du bruit. Fais du bruit means make some noise.
There we go.
And then we've got prepare de coller is get ready for takeoff. So, I say, apologies for our French. We're doing our best.
Yep.
Un petit peu.
I don't even speak your language. I speak American. I don't speak English. So
your mom must be so disappointed in you for the French thing as well, Jack.
So she grew up in Poitiers, France. I grew up in San Diego County, which is the closest to Mexico. I'm even half Mexican. She says, take French. I failed French. Still don't know Spanish. That's why I say I speak American loud and proud. So, you know, the only one I do know is mon petit chou.
Huh?
Qu'est-ce que c'est français? Mon petit chou?
Je ne comprends pas.
No, my little cabbage.
Ah, thanks, mate. Cheers. I can remember a bunch of stuff from school. Où est la piscine, which is where's the swimming pool. Je voudrais une baguette. I would like a baguette. I mean, unfortunately, that's not really conversational French for a bar. So we do our best. Always, here's my top tip. Traveled quite a lot, Jared. I'm sure you'll understand this as well. Please and thank you. Go a long way in whatever country you go to. And try and make a little bit of an effort. Make an effort. Even if you can't do it, people appreciate it. And we're like, you know, speaking English, we're a bit lazy, I'm afraid. It's fair to say, isn't it? English or American, because everybody speaks it, we're a bit lazy. And
speak for yourself.
Here in French Canada, it's nice to be here, man. It's nice to be here.
I love it. And I have some great friends here in Montreal, and I have a Quebec tattoo. Fun fact.
Do you?
I do.
What is it?
It's the logo. It's kind of the four-leaf clover logo. So Montreal, Quebec, and I have a Canadian, a Japanese maple leaf on my leg too. So I've been tattooed here a few times.
There you go.
I'm probably gonna get another one. So a fleur de lis. No, I'll show it to you later. Our director's correcting me. I know what's on my body. So Joel Mayo out front, Moreau sitting in second, Moreau in third, and the other Mayo out back, and that's Pops. We're talking about Jerome Mayo.
Talking about what's on your body, Jared, I didn't know you owned any long pants. I think
I
that's what you call the America, isn't it? I was half expecting you to be here in shorts.
Well, they haven't panned down. I'm only wearing a jacket. I did get a Ken Block tattoo. I did get a 43.
I got his
last number that he ran, which was the Death Spray, who I introduced him to it. But the 43.
Talking of the 43, we mentioned it's been retired. I must add to that, it's been retired except for if one of the Block family wants to run it. So if Leah Block chose to do Group E and wanted to run 43, no worries.
And FIA WRC retired it as well.
They have, and I'm sure they'd honor that too. And I love that because it's a number that became synonymous with a name, and that name is Ken and his family. And Leah, I love the idea of her. If she wants to, she'd do whatever she likes. The whole motorsport world's here to support the family and the kids if they want to follow in Ken's footsteps. And if one of them wanted to run the 43, I think that'd be rad. I really do.
Absolutely, out of respect.
Yeah.
All right, so let's talk about this right now. We are lap 4 of 5, and Mayo, who got in early on into the snowbank. You can see that battle damage on that back right corner, but seems to find the sweet spot now, and now has a 5.3 second. What, it got a little
squirrely. Ran the bank on the inside. Do not roll this car. Oh, there's the other one buried in the wall. Do not roll this car.
What'd you do?
When we've been told.
You can't park there.
Matthew, the guy who runs the team, he said to me, yeah, they're all going to look after the car because of the rally in 3 weeks' time. This is day one of two. One of them's in the bank. The other one's been up the bank. I mean, it's they're not being that careful, are they? Maybe there's a future for them in Rallycross yet, Jared.
We got a late entry coming in tomorrow.
Four Subarus, joining the back of the Group E grid. Yeah, I think there might be a regulatory issue there. But
we are on the final lap. Let it be noted, the white flag is out, and Mayo, who has a 5.9-second lead on Moreau, Morissette sitting in third, and we talked about Jerome Mayo. He was back there on the bank. So it looks like Joel, we had a great conversation just about everything that has transpired over the last few weeks regarding Block. But there is the checkered flag as Joel Mayo gets the victory in Rally four-wheel drive. It is a doubleheader for both four-wheel drive, side-by-side, and two-wheel drive rally. So that's how it culminates now. So Mayo, and you can see that battle damage there from Moreau.
Hawkeye, wasn't it, in P2? There's the Bug Eye. Just so much Subaru love, man.
Did you ever own a Subaru?
No, I'd love to.
I had an 03 WRX wagon. Yep. And there are the results there. Jerome Mayo out front. Are you sure about that? Okay.
It is, Jerome. Yeah, the Canadian rally champion, the son who takes it. Yoel, the dad, unfortunately, in the wall. We thought at one point Yoel might take it, didn't we, after turn one, but maybe decided that the family contact wasn't the greatest way to spend pay the bills.
The lights are on and the party continues. Speaking of party, Street Bike Tommy's always a party. Where you at?
One of my major hang-ups so far is that I've realized that there's a severe language barrier between English and French. And my man here is going to help me out with a little translation to create a little bit of content for you guys at home. I need to learn how to say one phrase.
That'll get you anywhere in winter here?
Yeah, well, I'm...
Une phrase pour avoir l'air un peu innocent?
Yeah. Are you sick?
It's my life.
I don't know if I can do the
It's malade.
It's super malade.
There you go! There you go! Fantastic!
They're an excitable bunch here.
Voulez-vous?
Voulez-vous?
Fa
bomb.
Bonhomme de neige.
Bonhomme de neige.
Bonhomme de neige.
De neige.
There you go, bonhomme de neige.
Yeah.
So,
Thomas la légende en français.
Yeah, see, I speak French now. And I believe I asked you, do you want to build a snowman?
That's
all
that
would stink. No?
No.
Oh.
I'm trying. That's my try.
So, Dang. So, man, that's one thing I wasn't really prepared for. I didn't know that there's... How do you make it sticky?
Hotter?
Yeah?
In the winter.
Yeah. All right. Who would have thought that was going to be an issue, that you can't build a snowman out here? Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Have a great night.
Yeah, you too. Enjoy the races.
See you at home. Peace out.
Back to you.
It's almost time for some more racing here in Trois-Rivières, and it's actually down to teammates. Andreas Backrud, who's sitting second in championship points, and Robin Larson, who's sitting in first. I asked Andreas what his thoughts were about going up against his teammate. He said, man, he has been consistent all year long. And realistically, we've been battling all year long. He said, it's going to be a good one. He said, one thing, though, to watch for, as we've been talking about all night, is that start. One pro, though, of not necessarily getting the best start, the visibility is clean up front, but you can always watch the brake lights of the person in front of you, feel out where the grip is for them or where it isn't for them, and capitalize on them when the mistake is made.
Thank you for some great insight there, Katie. Let's take a look at the event. Yeah, it looks absolutely awesome. Picturesque. Almost as beautiful as you, Coley.
Oh, thanks, Jared.
Robin Larson, Andreas Backrud, Fraser McConnell, and Ollie Erickson. Look at the variety, man. We got a couple Swedes, you got a Jamaican, and you got a Norwegian.
Now, in terms of picking grid positions, we covered off earlier on, it was the higher classified driver for the first rounds. Obviously, now each of them has won their quarterfinal and gone through, but it still goes back now to timed practice earlier on. So Robin Larson was the fastest driver in timed practice, so he gets to choose pole ahead of Andreas Backrud. Fraser McConnell, where was he? Fraser versus Ollie Erickson.
What's at stake
point-wise? Fraser was faster.
TQ. So. Let's talk about TQ. What's up? I mean, there's a few points that are up for grabs.
Yeah, there's points. But just a little bit. Also, it could make a difference.
We're talking about the four-wheel drive class and all-wheel drive class, in Rally. And here are basically the, you got the RX Cartel, DRR, JC teammates going against each other. You want to keep it safe. You want to stay off each other. But knowing them, they still want to get the victory. So, yeah.
I think it's very much going to come down to the start. Whoever gets the better start, neither of these two is going to fire the other one off when they're in P1 and P2 in the championship standings. They're not going to want to give the team a bunch of work to do overnight. They both made it through to the semi, so they're both going to be on the front row tomorrow, remember, in their respective heat races. So they've done enough to make tomorrow a little bit easier, but both of them are going to want to take this off the line. There is Larson looking down, changing the settings on the wheel. There you can see the big paddle for the gear shift on the right-hand side. Lots of people surprised these cars have got gears, but they have three gears.
We saw that Florida Lee flag. So that's Montreal, right? But I want to show my director here. So the Montreal City logo is the coat of arms from the island of Montreal. So that's the other logo. And that's tattooed on my body. So that's what I have. So that represents... and my director has apologized now, so thank you very much. I do know what a Florida Lee is, so just FYI.
Whereabouts is that one?
I can't show you right now. All right, so we are about to go into our semifinals, talking about the RX Cartel, the DRRJC. They're out for blood, man. And I really love what, Larson and everybody's demeanor this season has been really good. The Ericssons, they get a little fired up. Ollie gets really spirited, and that means he wants to win, And they know what's at stake, and they know how this car works. So kind of it's like, oh, let me show how to do that, So but everybody's attitude's been really good this season, and it's been, really interesting, at Lytton Hill. Nobody knew what to expect, and everybody's like, how's it going to take a hit? I think it's held up really, really well. I mean, given all the conditions from Lytton to, obviously to Sweden to, obviously now in the States and now here in the cold. It's been a really good beginning debut year.
They're having to take a little bit more of a hit here as well, Jared, because these tires are heavier. They will shave off the tread, but when you put 325 metal studs into a tire, the difference is 11 pounds per corner on the tire. That's 5 kilograms in European money. That's a lot. It's a lot. So add that in the rotating mass, as you say, and that's why when you get things like wheel-to-wheel contact like we saw early on with Bennett, you can get the studs engaging, but just the sheer extra volume of weight. And if you want a little demo of it, go and I asked somebody yesterday. They went, no way in the paddock. I said, go and pick them up. And she picked up the first of the wheels without the studs in, and then the second one was like, okay, wow, big difference. There really is a big difference. So it's a lot of weight in it. Yeah, you're right. We've put these cars through the ringer in their first year of development. Some big old jumps. You've got Pastrana's car now getting re-prepped for tomorrow. So Vermont Sports car. Looks like Martel's car's good to go. Look, that's everybody's calm that side of the garage. But they're underneath Pastrana's. There is that Yokohama. Handmade in Sweden. Flown over 100 tyres here for the 9-10 cars over the course of the next 2 weekends. Normally you would use 12 tyres in one race weekend. So 24 tyres over 2 race weekends. They're only going to use 8 over the course of both race weekends. Of course, they just don't wear out in the same way. As long as they're driving on ice, if we start to cut through to gravel, that's when the studs get damaged. So that's why you've got to maintain the track a little bit as well. It's not simple running these things. Look at that. Look at that tyre. They're weapons, aren't they? Don't get run over by it. Wow. You don't want your foot driven over by a car ever, but not one with a 12-wheel stud. Look at that. Steel toe caps, not enough.
Hellraiser.
It's good, isn't it? 325 studs in each of those tyres. Another couple out the back as well. Look. So Larsen, left-hand side of your screen. Backward on the right-hand side of your screen.
So this is from the quarterfinals previously. This is, they're going against each other next. Let's take a look at the wheel. Look at, you know, think about Larsen went on earlier, right? And then Backerud.
Larsen got that bad start against Bennett, Jared, and you could just see Bennett on the outside. Watch on the left-hand side of your screen, see if we see Bennett again. He's behind, but he hits Larsen any time now. You might see the contact from behind. Ooh. There it was, and then Bennett ended up in the wall on the outside line. It was only small from on board, but it was enough to put Bennett off to the side of the track. Backerud, right-hand side of your screen, look with that rotation. Trying to figure out, I think we've got Backerud's audio. Hold on. Yeah, we have, I think. Unless we've got a combination of the two, but through the long right-hander, then gas, if you want to call it that, loud pedal, the throttle, down that one wiper, working away through the double apex left-hander. It's actually 290 left, which you can sweep through as one turn if you want. Wheel lighting up there, going green. You see 124 kilometers an hour at turn into turn one. That's on the exit from turn seven, all the way through there now. Watching down the straight, look, this is where we were looking at backward speed. Went 140 and just touched up to 150 kilometers an hour at the end of the straight. So it's close to 160 clicks, which would be close to 100 miles an hour. So pretty impressive. So yes, it was 120 miles an hour at the end of the straight and 80 miles an hour in turn two, which is very impressive. But that was when the studs were really digging into the ice and we had around 4 inches of snow. Into the joker for backward. It's a good look at that joker. Doesn't look much difference, but me and Jared have figured out it's a 3.2 second delta, so that's what you need to be ahead. And of course, these drivers are about to go head to head and see which one of them makes it through to the final.
And that's if you're tidy. You know, that the variables.
That's a good one, right?
And the track as in its most ideal conditions. And now, you know, we're doing some maintenance on it, but not to the degree that we started at today when we started the battles. Now going in further, getting softer, it's getting fluffier, you're slowing down, you're not getting that good grip, you're not getting that good traction. You know, imagine an ice rink compared to going snowboarding at your local resort. You know, it's two very different conditions. Consider that grip. So two very different grip levels. So going to that Yokohama Tire Joker lap. Some great onboard there with our DRR JC RX Cartel drivers who are currently leading the championship with only 4 rounds left, one of which is here, Calgary, and then it has been announced, March. Join us in Los Angeles, baby. Come on. We are going to be partying at Glen Helen, an iconic track, you know, on any Sunday. We were there earlier this year. We saw some great success from those guys. Are they going to go back there and kind of attack? Are they going to kind of, you know, just dive that sword in a little deeper and get that championship? But all they're diving in right now are those Yokohama tires, stakes and sleds, and as Katie calls them, bling on those tires. So the Ericssons getting poised, and only Ollie is in the mix as Kevin Ericsson was knocked out earlier.
So it's worth pointing out, Ollie Ericsson has had two top qualifiers this year. So has Robin Larsen.
True.
Fraser McConnell had a top qualifier, which was at Glen Helen, where we're going back. McConnell, of course, with the top qualifier and with the win in Glen Helen. So of these four drivers, it's actually Andreas Backerud is the only one of them that hasn't had a top qualifier spot yet. So he's up against it, Jared, because the others have already been there. But I reckon he's up for it.
All right. So with some more updates, throwing down to Katie.
Well, of course, out here in the pits, the guys who are really ready to race tonight are out in the pre-grid. Meanwhile, Chris Meek and team, they're actually working on the gearbox still. This is something they want to check all the balances, make sure everything is fired up and wired accurately, since it was such a thrash and dash to get pulled together. Oliver Bennett's car here, on the other hand, is looking mighty fine, as they were saying. It's in good condition, and a lot of people around here in the teams are very comfortable and confident with where that car is in here tonight. And the Vermont sports car team, both of them are in their stables, unfortunately, here tonight. But hey, it's all about the racing right now, and that is where we're about to go green.
All right, there is Backerud, the boy in blue. He's got his blue crew cheering him on. Backerud, like you said, can he get that TQ spot? Robin Larsen, Backerud, teammates, but now they're fighting for position to go into the final. Fraser McConnell and Ollie Eriksson on the other side.
Now, Larson got a bye through round one. Jared, he chose the low line in the other two ones. I think he's chosen the low line against his teammate Andreas Backerud here as well.
Here we go, Group E. There are the stats. Sweden versus Norway. Fairly equally matched. You see the event SF, top qualifier. Beat Kevin Eriksson in battle quarterfinal. Beat Ollie Bennett. All right, let's see who comes out on top. This is bragging rights at the bar later.
It is. Remember last time Larson got...
But keep it clean.
Yeah, you got that super wheel spin start Larson did and almost lost out to Bennett. Bennett was on the outside, so that time the low line paid off for him. Andreas Backerud got the rocket start, if you remember, from the high line.
And Larson spins him again. So Larson spins him again. Backerud got that good grip. You saw the attitude of Larson's car. It was like squirrely. He was dancing left to right, and that very well could be. But look at Larson swinging wide, and Andreas Backerud keeping that tight. Like, look at that. Absolutely blinded by this snow blast. I mean, that is insane. You can't see a darn thing. That's worse than dust.
Yeah, the bravery of Larson there, I can't overstate how brave you have to be. Larson's taken a lot of alternative lines. So the second he lost the start, Jared, he went high. He ran backward high, partly visibility, but also took a line maybe with less ruts through. Got in the roost, couldn't see anything at all, nearly put it in the outside wall. Again, he went wide. He's right there on the back of him. He's 0.5 of a second back. We know the delta's 3.2, but if he can get a few purple sectors in this one, he's got one already, look, on that first lap. So Larson will look to close backward down. He's going to have one lap to do it because backwards has to go on the next one. It's only a two-lap race.
I got to tell you, that snow blow was insane. That was the best depiction we've seen of being blinded by the snow. You know, Larson just was absolutely white out.
The bravery, dude. But you could just see a red light. Imagine pinning a car with nearly 1,000 horsepower onto an icy straight on studded tires when literally it's like someone is blowing snow across the screen. Mistake from backward, was it there? Or were we on board?
Look at
the car snapping sideways. So gap's gone up to 4.1 according to the timing, but that didn't look comfortable for Backerud through this turn. I'm keen to see what it is now.
Larson is really getting after it. I'm glad they kept off each other. You know, you want to see clean racing. You want to see the best equipment out as possible. Here they go into the Yokohama Tire Joker lap. Can Larson get him? If he is tidy, he might catch him. And there we go. Backerud holds on to it. So, again, that four-second gap still. But, again, that looked about 3.8. It looks like I said. It went from 3.2, 3.5, 3.8. Look at Larson just chomping at him, still getting snowblowed out.
This isn't over yet, is it, Jared? Look, Larson's looking up the inside. Was going to make Andreas go defensive. He was hoping to get a better run onto the straight. He went high and wide on that first lap. Can Larson pull anything out of the back on the run to the finish line here?
And here we go. I think Backerud's got it in the back. This big, long turn one. And look at Larson. Oh, my gosh. He is entering a drift competition. Big angle there from Larson. And he's not going to hold on to it. But look at that wheel speed. I mean, that was absolutely on it. He pinned it. Robin Larson trying to fight for it, but a fist pump from Backerud signifies he got the win over his RX Cartel DRRJC teammate. So Dreyer Reinbold, it was a lose-win situation, obviously. So unfortunately, it wasn't Larson, but you know, stoked Backerud. And like you said, right before they started, the only guy not to have a TQ. One more race to get his first.
But we need to look after the steering, just double check, like the joints and stuff, Ian, Ingers, you know the drill.
Approx 20 minutes.
All right, so taking a look at it again here as Andreas Backerud, and that was the moment we saw Robin Larson absolutely getting snow blast. Look at this. Bye. Where'd he go?
Keeps it buried, Jared. That's the thing. And in fact, he ran just a little bit too deep. If he hadn't run deep, I think he might have got a run. Look at the accuracy there. Runs the nose over those tires on the right-hand side. This was the Joker merge. He just took a tenth off. He took a tenth off Backerud just before they went in. We were riding on board. I wasn't sure who it was with at the time. There was just a little bit of a sideways snap. Backerud had a couple of moments, didn't he, as well, when he was holding on out front. Look at the pace of Larson, trying to go high and wide, just gets a bit too much rotation in the middle of the corner, scrubbed a bit of its speed off, but that start is absolutely critical.
Yeah. All right, the track just taking a beating. The fans are getting a show. You can see them off there to the right, the casino, the grandstands, fans enduring, just having a cold beverage, regardless of what it is. It's going to be cold. Even if it's a hot coffee, it's cold. Yeah. It's brisk out
Not for long.
No, yeah.
A hot coffee? No, sir. Iced coffee. Yeah, okay, that'll do. Whatever.
But I'm looking forward to Calgary, man. I believe I've been up there before once, but looking forward to going back. There it is, the Jamaican. That is Fraser McConnell getting ready.
So notice here the positioning of McConnell and Erickson. They're a little bit further apart. There's actually a line. You guys can't really see it at home, but it's painted with the same stuff you see if you watch downhill skiing. There's a blue line in the snow in the middle. And the drivers are allowed to put their car wherever they want, either side of that line. Exactly. So left or right side of the grid, put it where you want. That's to allow them to try and avoid some of those ruts. So be interesting to see who pulls this one off.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting when we get all the kind of stacked up grid. That's going to be really kind of cool. All right, so here we go. Looks like Fraser McConnell taking the high side. Ollie Erickson, he goes on the low side. You can see the sign, NITRO. Let's go. Send it. Who's going to get the victory? Who's going against Andreas Backrud? Looks a little bit squirrely from both of the vehicles. Ollie Erickson looks like he quickly gets the side of Fraser McConnell. But Fraser McConnell comes out on top, swings wide. And looks like Ollie Erickson is getting a bit of a lashing of snow on his windscreen as well. But Fraser McConnell, really fast. Just the way he's putting down the power and the speed, he seems to just be having a different kind of boost, it seems like.
Well, remember the team said earlier on this year at Glen Helen that from their data, McConnell had been quickest on the gravel nearly everywhere he went. At that point, that was at ERX, I think, then Glen Helen, we'd had a couple of tracks that had some tarmac and pavement sections in them. We've now been full dirt, and McConnell's been quick everywhere. Yeah. You can liken the driving style of snow and ice to similar conditions, but don't forget, Fraser McConnell first drove a car on studded tyres on ice last week in Finland after Larson, don't forget, rinsed him in his stories about how he hadn't done any driving on snow and ice at all. And then Peter rung me. He said, yeah, they're in for a surprise. He's on his way to Finland. He was going to keep it a secret, but Fraser was having so much fun driving a Mitsubishi Lancer around a frozen lake that he ended up posting it all over social media. So, but Jared, what kind of a job is the Jamaican doing, say, the least Amazing. Experience in these conditions?
Yeah.
And he's looking like he's going to go through to the final, but he's not going done yet.
And he's going against a guy who probably has the second most seat time behind the wheel of FC1X. You know, Kevin Erickson, you know, he kind of had more seat time, but the Erickson brothers, both of them, you know, Olsbergs, his dad Andreas, you know, developing this vehicle, the Olsbergs camp.
Gap's gone up to 4.8, Jared. Fraser McConnell doing a brilliant job here. Watch for the left foot brake comes on. He'll be on the handbrake in there as well. Flicks the car around. He's comfortably going to come out in front of Ollie Erickson. Now he's just got to hang on for the remainder of this lap. It's a brilliant drive. Snow roost up for Ollie Erickson. Up and over the crest there. Butters the landing. Gap's down to 1.2. Obviously now the jokers have played out. Fraz in those ruts. Look at the ruts on the exit of turn 6 now. 7, sorry, getting pretty tricky. So McConnell's just got to hold on.
All right, so here we go. Fraser McConnell, a couple more turns. And there it is. Looks like Ollie Erickson and gapping him. Taking him to Gappelby's, little blooming onion there. So it looks like Fraser McConnell, that big, long turn, number one sweeper. See the attitude of the car. Don't come inbound. 1010. That's not even a number. It's 1010. 114. Making up unobtainium numbers here. But Fraser McConnell is the unobtainium right now. He takes out Ollie Erickson, loosens the straps. Fist pump from the A-Shot Energy Jamaican driver.
29 minutes to the final. Yeah, we need to be completed in 29 minutes.
Okay, copy.
The banter there saying he needs to be somewhere.
The final starts in 29 minutes, so we should leave in 20 minutes.
Right, I'm not sure whose radio we're hearing. They're saying Fraz.
The first thing to do is charge, okay? As much as we can.
Okay, so they want to get just the car back and get it charged as quickly as possible. Remember what we were saying earlier, Jared, about temperatures here affect duration. Now, we're towards the end of these battle brackets. The cars go back and only get, say, 20 minutes or so to charge in between each one. You just keep topping the battery up to get through to the end. But what a brilliant job by McConnell.
And here we go. Yeah. Let's take a look at this launch here. They were pretty matched. They were matched pretty well, but then watch Fraz taking that higher line. It's not as soft, so maybe he got that grip. But a lot of those guys taking the higher line, it hasn't been beat up. So you got to think that traction is up there, and you're not getting the snow on your face.
Yeah, Larson did it in the previous run, didn't he? And yeah, okay, he was brave to stay in the throttle in the roost from Backrud, but I just think that alternate line where it's not quite so cut up, maybe you can carry a bit more speed through it, but so well executed by Fraser McConnell. And I'm quite excited for McConnell versus Backerud, Jared.
Yeah, Backerud versus Fraz. The checkered flag is his Fraz. Congratulations. So Fraser McConnell's going to the finals. All right, so we are getting ready to go, staying hydrated here at Nitro Rallycross, throwing down a good time. And let's take a look over here down at the paddock with Katie. All right, so here is, as far as the festivities go, here's our A-Shock Energy Nitro Rallycross Road to the Finish Line. Backerud versus McConnell are in the finals. As you said, Fraser McConnell got the TQ at Glen Helen.
He did. TQ and win.
And the win. So that's the perfect event. And that was what an event it was. And then Andreas Backerud has yet to see that TQ trophy. Congratulations to Fraser McConnell, Andreas Backerud. Let's see who comes out on top.
Look at that. Beautiful backdrop here. Trois-Rivieres, the city in the background. It's a good party town. On board with Larson. This was the first semi-final off the line, and Backerud looked clearly in front. So watch this now. Goes up on the high line. Look, he's in the smooth, on the throttle. Look, Backerud, left foot braking a bit to get the rotation in, while Larson's looking to come low. And then as he comes out the roost, whoa, I'm way higher on the straight than I thought it was going to be. Has to get out the throttle. But watch how he closes him down again here. So he comes in, look, he brakes late, he uses Backerud as his sighting point, runs the car out wide now, brings it in, where Backerud's defensive, bang, he's back on the back of him immediately. So some great driving from Larson, but let's be honest, I think it's proving a little bit hard to pass here. We did say earlier on, the opportunities will open up more when there's a pack. When there's a pack there, you defend from the guy in P2, and the guys in P3 and P4 manage to slide on past you, maybe it's gonna be a little bit more tricky. But there are a number of drivers who are looking super fast here. Great job by Backerud to go through from semi one. McConnell went through from semi two. Good final coming up.
All right, so you can see in the pits, Backerud talking to the fans, smile on his face. And look at put him to work. He's showing the brush and seeing the studs there, so clearing them out, maybe replacing some of those spikes as well.
They're tightening up the outside road, Jared. So I don't know, maybe where they're getting leaned on a bit more, they're just starting to come loose. But yeah, you can get a tool and just tighten the studs down a little bit more. So they're retained in a very different way from the rally studs.
Here are our side-by-side finals. Are we down to four now? All right, so our side-by-side finals. So we got Greg Michaud, you can see him there. Yeah, so it looks like we got a total of seven out here. So a total of seven in its entirety. We got the 27 of Greg Michaud. You got Bertrand Lambert, Martin Villard, Jonathan Tufaut, Joey Morrison, Jacques Gesselin, and Daniel Tardif. All right, let's see who comes out on top. Coley.
Yeah, Gregoire Michaud with a good start. Jared, pretty sideways from everyone. Note again that he chose the high line. So as the pole man, he's chosen the high line, and it's worked out perfectly. So he's straight out into the lead. I think it's Bertrand Lambert in that kind of single seat, the side-by-side, who's in P2. They do look a bit different, don't they, than the wider vehicles? And a variety of spec, different speeds coming down the straight. There's Michaud up in turn two. Watch this now. Get the rotation on the car, because two tightens into three. Little dip crest on the exit of three, and we're coming up then into turn four. So flip the car around the other way. Tight hairpin right, and then you're up into your joker. So standard lap inside, joker lap outside. At this point, Michaud will hold on because he knows what the visibility is like behind him. And then he'll flick it into the little tabletop jump in the background. Is that joker from P2 or P3?
I think it was P2. I think it was Lambert that went for the joker lap. We'll see, and there it is, yep. So the diamond flashing right next to the names, that implies and showcases that they did hit the Yokohama Tire joker lap. So Lambert, unfortunately, goes from second to third, but does have that, I would call it about that, you know, given the side-by-sides, probably about a four-second delta. All right, so Michaud out front, Gregor Michaud, Villard in second, Lambert sitting in third, Tufaut in fourth.
Sideways in the background, coming out onto the start straight.
All right, join us here in the booth, and we knew it was going to come, and here he joins us in the booth, and it's a place he doesn't like to be, but he does get some good insight on the track, his fellow racers, the overall. Travis Pastrana, join us in here in the building. Unfortunately, you're here with us. It means you're not in the finals. Some good racing. You still have a smile on your face. How is the track? What's the conditions? But first and foremost, what happened, man?
Yeah, I tell you what, if it could go wrong today, it pretty much did with me. But, you know, I tell you what, we're definitely quick. I feel like, I mean, every driver does, but I really feel like we're the fastest ones out there. Yeah. Greg. Sorry, I'm watching Greg here. Greg,
you raced him earlier, didn't you? He's absolutely killing it. How class is this guy? What we've seen the Canadian side by side. He's the only driver that we've kind of come across from Nitro side by side into Canadian side by side. He's a hell of a talent, isn't he?
He is so good. I tell you what, he's been doing absolutely awesome. Look at him just pitching this car. They don't have the spikes that we do. So he's a super, super aggressive driver. He's been giving Deegan and myself fits all year round when we were on the side-by-sides. But definitely good to see him out there. So you see, these tires don't have the spikes. They're Yokohamas as well. But just ours, by yourself, it feels... Before it gets all powdery on the outside, it feels like you're on the best traction you've ever had. You throw it in, but then the second lap you have less traction. The third lap you have less traction. You can see, obviously right there. Who's that?
Gosselin. Yeah, parked at the side of the road.
I think it was Squirrely on the last race too as well. So I think might be having some issues. But
look at Greg, and they're trying to save the course, as you can see.
Yeah, putting the cones out,
which is making it difficult for these guys to kind of go around, but it's actually making the course really, really good. And Greg's just putting on a show out there.
He's not making it that difficult, is he? Really? His accuracy on some of those cones has been fantastic. It's a huge lead of 10.9 seconds when he's come out.
This battle here for a second, though, really, really good. So our tires, they're so amazing, but we don't have, it's like a slick tire with a 1-inch or 2-inch spike, basically. So when we get outside the main line, it goes from where you have the best traction I've ever had, better than any pavement we've ever done, to you're on a slick in the snow, and you've got absolutely nothing. So really good to see Larson get up on the top line, and just when you put the power down, it digs down, right? So if you have your tire speed at twice whatever your speed's going, unlike in pavement where it just takes off, it'll grip in, and it was awesome to see Larson really come around the top.
McConnell did the same, didn't he, with Ollie Ericsson? We were just speculating. Obviously, we're just looking at pictures and trying to figure out whether or not that slightly less rutted outside high line might work a bit. Larson tried to carry the speed. The roost was unbelievable. You couldn't see anything.
No, I mean, he just stayed in it.
Yeah,
it was like a motocross race in the mud. You're like, I hope I'm still on the track. Oh, here we go. Greg hitting the outside bale right there, or the hay bales. Yeah, geez. The snowbank.
We know what you meant.
The snowbank.
Yeah. We know what you meant.
And we know what you did, too.
But it pulls it in really, really quick. So,
how is the track transforming? Because, like you talked about, that kind of inside line is very loose. It's getting soft. So you kind of have a ski resort, and then you kind of, I wouldn't say an ice rink by any means, but the firmer on the outside and get looser on the inside.
Well, the coolest part is it's gonna favor the drivers that are super aggressive. Not maybe when the track's fresh, because you can really drive it tidy and kind of like a Scott Speed. But this is gonna favor the guys like the Ken Blocks. I feel like the guys like
getting a little loose, a little more styling.
Man, he's looking better and better. He's never been on snow, but he just keeps his right foot down, and that is going to pay off huge dividends towards the end. The track gets, and you'll see these little ruts, so you can't be smooth. And this is the thing. So I actually hit my power steering off. I thought I just quit, but you're moving your hands so fast on this car. So I turn my power steering off. I dislocate my thumb. I put it in the side. I break the windshield. I'm like, well, this is great. Full Ken Block style. Like, we were quick until we weren't.
Then
I go out. Yeah, I ain't care. And I go out, and I didn't shift up to – I hit down to second by accident. So there's so many buttons and so many switches that you are fumbling around. Or maybe it's just me. Maybe everyone else is being smooth and tiny.
Greg, you have like an onboard in a minute, you're trying to figure it out.
Yeah, but you can see even Greg, who's a super smooth driver, it's when you're in the rut, you have so much traction. Or when you're in the polished area, when you get out of it, you have nothing. And it happens so fast, and your natural reaction is to let off the gas.
Yeah.
But if you let off the gas, the tires don't dig in.
What group were you in yesterday? Group 1 or Group 2? For the very first session,
Group 1, and
was it cool. That's why we were still in the balcony of the casino watching. You've scale electrics, you've heard of, the little cars on the track. So dude, it looks like
car.
I've literally, that's what I mean, I've never seen car speed like that. So it was insane.
Greg's coming around almost for the win here, but we were wide open around turn 1, second lap. I was like, this is the greatest, craziest thing I've ever done. Turn 2, we came around, I think Fraz backed it into the wall. Everyone's like, whoa, what just happened? And real quick, Greg.
Michaud's going to get the victory. Lambert with a 9.4-second gap. Looks like Lambert's going to get second. Villard with third. You can see there is no opportunity for Lambert to catch. And Michaud just masterclass from the start to the finish and just showing you why he's so dominant in the side-by-sides. Travis Pastrana giving us some great accolades. And you know, Coley and I have seen it all season, all year. The Can-Am's a great addition.
Oh, what's the line, Jared? He's lost out just at the line. I think Lambert did. Lambert just rolled over. I thought he was going to lose two places there. He just held on. It's a good job the cars behind saw him.
What just happened?
Lambert barely crawled across the finish line.
Just made it. I mean, he's in there going, no.
Lambert just pulled off three wide earlier. It was such a good battle, and it's so cool these side-by-sides to see so much a different variety of narrow, wide,
And the spec as well. I met a guy yesterday, Senator Jared, who literally bought a side-by-side this year for the first time ever for fun, came and raced it here, and is now loving the opportunity to be here with Nitro Rallycross. It's good to see the variety of machines, but a familiar name at the top of the table there with Greg Warmashode, who's been killing it in Nitro side-by-side, and as Travis said, giving him and Deegan a headache. So much of a headache, mate, that you quit the side-by-sides. Have you ever been? What's going on there?
I would love to be in there, but when you don't
focus,
qualify through in the first heat on side-by-sides and you're...
Need to focus, don't
yeah.
you?
Yeah. Well, you know, Fraz tried earlier this year. It's awesome when everything works, but wow, that was
so close. You know when you go karting and you bounce, yeah? But he's sitting in there bouncing, desperately trying to make it down.
There are the standings. So Gregor Michaud, Lambert, Villard, Tafoe, Morrison, Tardif, and Gosselin. So Travis, some great insight. Don't go anywhere. We're going to go to finals.
What we're actually going to do as well is we're going to go back and we're going to take a look at another one of our finals. Now, normally, you know, obviously, I'm sure you'd love to hear me and Jared commentating over it, but we're not. We're going to take that off because Travis Pastrana's here.
Uh-oh.
And it's the final that he won in Phoenix. So we're going to take a look back at Travis's final from Phoenix, where he became the first double winner. I think you were the round five, weren't you? So the first double winner of the season was Travis Pastrana.
You're not first, you're last.
Let's have a little throwback.
This
here we go.
This was the first night race. The track just came in. It was so awesome. Also new racing here in the night as well. Meek had my number all weekend. He was definitely the quickest, but unfortunately, here I'm. Jeez, Erickson right there.
Carnage in the background.
So we had a vote, and I was like, look, just the way this track came together, I don't know if we can do jumps right off the bat. And everyone was like, this is Nitro Rallycross, except for Andreas Backerud. And Andreas goes, I don't know, I think someone's going to crash. And sure enough, Backerud has never flipped a car before this year. And, well, he's flipped twice in six rounds, but he's flipped a total of 11 times in those two wrecks. So.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, it's true.
Oh,
yes, he made up for all those years without getting it done. So, you've gone Joker here on that one because the Joker's shorter in Phoenix. It's our only shorter Joker this year. That's the standard tactic, defend the lead. It's a very different situation. So what's your spotter saying to you now that you're coming in the emerging? How's it different from when you're trying to tactically take a spot?
Well, honestly, he said, oh, crap, Meek's behind you. And Meek was getting 5-6 Gs every single lap. He jumps to flat on everything. He does not care. This guy, I mean, he had just broken tib fib. Finished riding like literally 200 kilometers back to the hospital, flew himself out with a compound fracture tip. He is the toughest guy I know. He's the most aggressive driver I know. He's had a lot of trouble this year, but dude, even from the back starting here, I think he's a threat to win this race. The snow dust is tough. This was so great because we realized at night we could keep, in Phoenix, we had such a hard time keeping the dust down, but at night everything just stayed, and that's why they do so many of the dirt late models and everything at night, and I think that's going to be what we're going to try to do in the future.
The moisture, yeah, just manages to keep things down a little bit. So Friday night lights there, it's kind of Friday night lights here as well. I like it. I think it's cool, you know.
Well, look, I mean, you had four wide coming in there, and that was Chase Elliott earlier that day came in wide open. It was cool to have Austin Cindric, Daytona 500 winner. Chase Elliott was at this race, and everybody mixed it up. Everyone that's here, and look, Fraz, his car was broken every single run. So he ended up, we got together in the next night, or the next day here, and Fraz came in. I was like, there's no way he's going to try to make this pass, and we were both broken, but at the end of the day, that's what Nitro is about. It's about taking chance, about having fun. And, what's Ken Block always say?
Ain't care. Yep.
Risk everything.
Risk everything. Go fast.
Yep. But this was cool because my teammate and I, we went, Connor Martel, came from motocross. I came from motocross, and we unfortunately have the exact. Oh man,
Nothing's crab walking.
If Fraz ever doesn't do a jump, it's because the car is actually like it just won't run.
My favorite thing here, Travis, is the things you're seeing which you've never seen before. Because he's only seen this obviously from the driving seat. Said, oh man, look at that in the background! Like there was a lot going on.
There was a lot because the two drivers that finished second and third started. They went to the LCQ. They started back row. And to get my teammate up there, I've been saying the whole year, I'm like, this driver is absolute phenomenal. Connor Martel is such a great driver. And if he had Scott Speed on his team, I think he'd be a lot better.
You keep saying that. You're the first ever, double winner.
I'm quick and Connor's quick, but when you have someone that's your opposite, a guy like Brandon Semenuk, who is super smooth and does everything opposite, you can figure out how to drive the track differently. Connor and I drive the track exact the same. So we go out, we're two of the top three in practice. We're like, we are fast, but we don't know where the other drivers are quick.
I think we saw a very similar thing with Travis and Scott Speed that we'd seen in the World Championship with Johan Kristoffersen and Petter Solberg. I'm calling you Solberg and Speed Kristoffersen. Petter would like you see Petter next week race the champions, aren't you?
Yeah,
so he's heading over to America. You and Tanner, isn't it?
Tanner Fausend.
Travis Pastrana heading up to Northern Sweden. Actually, I remember last year, me and Petter Solberg FaceTimed you from the bar, and I think you were in a hospital bed. Do you remember? I don't know if it was a welcome call.
I was peeing through a tube right there, yeah. Cranberry juice. Unfortunately, missed that with Jimmy Johnson. I got sixth with Jimmy Johnson in 2006, so I missed that opportunity. But two Californians got second at Race of Champions last year on the snow and ice. I was really surprised. Timmy Hansen Matthias Ekstrom.
Yep.
I thought they were going to be the favorites. And then the father-son team, of the Solbergs.
They
beat him out.
Petter and Ollie. Ollie's crushing right now. Ollie's crushing today at WRC.
During
his second stage, he just, unfortunately. The second stage yesterday.
Today he's crushing it. But
how are we going to get one of the Solbergs to come and have a go at this, Travis?
I want both of them. Shoot.
Well, so do I. But
we need the
Vegans
over here. We need the Solbergs over here.
Yeah, we're calling you out. Negotiate. I had to go last year to the Race of Champions because you were in the hospital bed, if you remember.
You can go this Vettel, time. If you're watching this, you got to fly a car. You absolutely, positively have to come over. You said you liked rally. This is a good series. You're going to enjoy it. I swear.
That's what we need. That is what we need. I want to see Shane Van Gisbergen, the V8 driver.
We want to see a lot of people.
Guess what?
My man's busy. He's got Daytona 500. He's got all these things. So don't go anywhere. Travis, again, need to pay some bills. Thank you so much again. We're sending all the invites. Expect a card in the mail.
Thank you so much.
You're coming. You're all coming to Nitro Rallycross. Keep the party coming. Don't go anywhere. We have our Group E final bracket battle, and it's all going down here. First ever ice race. Don't go anywhere. Nitro Rallycross. More when we come back.
A-Shock, a modern performance energy drink created for today's active generation. Yokohama Tire, make every drive a performance. My Energy, driving the charge to a sustainable future.
It's almost time for why we all showed up here today, and it is for the final battle bracket. It's going down between Fraz McConnell and Andreas Backrud here in just a short bit, but the guys are still planning to get a little bit ready. Come on in. You can see that Fraz over here is about to push that helmet on, but before we do that, you were warming up a little bit. Travis Estrana was just talking about you on air, saying you might be the guy to beat. You're looking pretty strong out there. How confident are you? Because he's pretty confident in you.
I'm having fun, and when I'm having fun, everything seems to go easy. So I'm going to keep it that way and, go represent the black, green, and gold how I'm supposed to.
You kissed an egg on the back of your helmet I saw last time you went in the car. What's that all about?
Cool runnings. And we're making history on ice just like them this weekend. And we'll do the same thing in Calgary. You want to kiss it?
Why, of course. What a treat, man. That was cool.
Thank you. Time to go to work.
Let's go, Jamaica. All right, and we're going to move along in the pits here. Of course, as he's getting all fired up, suited up, we'll see if Andreas Backrud, we can sneak in for a quick conversation. This is kind of the pits back here. It's kind of an exciting place where obviously people are lined up, but really the drivers are the ones to beat.
wiping off those shoes to make sure they don't get dirty in the car. Andreas, as you kind of are gearing up here, how important is it to have clean feet?
I mean, when it comes to my mechanic here, Ian, it's the number one priority, you know. Now it's all about those small details. The start is so crucial out here, and if you spin away in the start, you're kind of gone. So just trying to keep like doing our job and trying to be consistent with everything we're doing. So I'm just grateful to have such a mechanics that are always putting in a little extra.
All right, wishing you the best out, the luck out there. Another guy who's probably having a little bit of fun out there is our buddy Tommy. What you got?
What's up, guys? I'm down here, actually standing in the stands. It is so cold out here. I'm not used to this, but it doesn't seem to be bothering anybody else. I didn't dress for it. I don't own any heavy-duty snow gear. Apparently, I get wet legs and feet and stuff. I bought these boots for $15 at one of those marts, whatever the marts are. But that was my extent of my preparation to get down here. But it turns out this crowd has awesome energy. Everybody's having a good time, but there's a language barrier. I'm going to try to get everybody hyped up. We're at Trois-Rivieres. Yes! Yeah! We got some good fans down here. Everybody's having a good time. It is cold, and they don't seem to care. As long as that beer's flowing and the cars are racing, we're having a good time. Back to you guys.
You can see a little bit of track maintenance out there. You see the kind of water trucks. You see dragging the course, kind of a bit of a Zamboni machine, and some great insight there from Travis. He's always spirited, but
he makes me laugh.
It's what he says when the cameras are on is even funnier. I'll just tell you that. Just we'll leave it at that. So we'll just leave it at that. It's so funny.
Hey, look, he set himself a target and he set himself a punishment. They were both pretty entertaining.
Yep.
We'll let you know on Sunday. Tomorrow, Saturday.
So this is how the day started. We saw that Ollie Bennett, Robin Larson battle, and Larson came out on top after a little bit of battling and bickering there. And then we saw Kevin Erickson and Backeroo.
That was that wild start, Jared, from the outside line. Yeah. That was the first time we were like, okay, cool, you can make it work from outside.
Exactly. Kind of a bit of a hack, right?
Yeah, inside from McConnell, look, just boosts it off the line with Chris Meek. Fraser McConnell, if you just said a week ago when he was, he called me from Heathrow, he was waiting for his connection in Heathrow. I was like, where are you going? He said, I'm going to Finland. I was like, oh no, I spoke to your dad yesterday. And he was so, so excited, but also obviously a bit nervous having not done it before.
He's the guy to beat.
Yeah,
I honestly think he's the guy to beat because he's not overthinking.
Yeah.
Sometimes, when you go in and do something, it's like, oh, beginner's luck. I don't say beginner's luck. No. I want to say that beginners, you kind of learn what that Larson,
so
that whiteout was insane.
So good.
So this is just a shape of things to come. Keep in mind, here we are in battle brackets. We're going to get to 8 cars before dinner time tomorrow. That's, we're talking East Coast time. So shoot, almost by brunch time for the West Coast.
Yeah, 4 or 5 car races, don't forget, for the heats. Then we're going to have a couple of 3 car races, I think, with the semifinals, and then onto the LCQ. Okay, only one driver won't make it, but there's going to be a bunch of multi-car racing tomorrow to get us through to that point in the finals. Yes, someone's going to miss out, but you guys aren't going to miss out when there are 8 cars in turn one. Definitely not.
And there we are, seeing the track prepped. It's taken some abuse, but I'll tell you what, in a great way. The fans sticking around, and they want to see who comes out on top. Is Backeroo going to get his first TQ of this season? Currently sitting second in points, his DRR JC, Dreyer Reinbold teammate from Sweden, currently leads the pack. He's from Norway. And then, or is it going to be Ollie Eriksson? Ollie Eriksson, Fraser McConnell. I apologize. Fraser McConnell, he got that perfect event at Glen Helen. And I'll tell you what, like I said, he is the guy to beat. He is driving like he's on dirt. He's just has this, go fast versus everything attitude, referencing Ken Block like Travis did earlier. What do you got? What's going through your mind, Coley?
I'm looking at points. You asked about points earlier, Jared, and I finally found the bit of paper that I wanted that's actually got the points on, because it's worth noting, don't forget, that Backeroo and McConnell are in that championship fight with Larson.
Yeah.
And so if Backeroo takes the TQ, he'll get 8 points for that. compared to Larson's 3 points for being a loser at the semi-final stage, and the loser of the final here gets 6 points as well. Doesn't sound like a lot, but yeah, we've got three rounds still to go. We're going to get to Calgary, of course. We've got the final points tomorrow. They've got to keep nibbling away and keep the pressure on to Larson. They need Larson to start thinking about it, because at the minute Larson's cruising and they want to apply that pressure. And both, and I'm pretty sure it's P2 and P3. Yeah, it is. It's P2 and P3 in the standings here are both into the final ahead of Larson, who's leading them.
And also keep in mind, think of the variety of winners we've had this season. You know, I mean, obviously, Frazier getting his first ever victory. Travis, yes, you know, first ever two-time winner. But it did come down to mere points.
Yeah.
Last year, remember, Scott's beat Travis Pastrana.
Yeah, it was one point. Yeah, exactly.
So that's why I say this. So every six point and counts. 8 points, every point counts.
Yeah.
So getting that TQ spot, you get the belt, you get the sticker, but I'll tell you what, every point counts. So as we're going to get the track up to speed, these guys are going to get up to speed, but getting us more up to speed is Katie Osborne.
Yeah, down here in the pits, and it's one of those places that, though there's not much behind me right now, you could tell the energy and the tension just getting ready for the final is really palpable. I mean, truly, the team is very excited. The one thing I think is very fascinating is that Andreas Backerud is still smiling. His spirit is so cool, calm, and collected. Meanwhile, Frazier McConnell, on the other hand, you can tell he's laser-focused, and it's very different inside that helmet. Though he does kiss an egg before it goes green, it is something that inside that helmet you can tell he really wants this win. Of course, they both do, but I think Frazier McConnell is coming out swinging, as he might have something to prove, especially being the guy who is probably the least familiar with ice, snow, and the cold weather.
Thank you for some great insight there. And like you said, just the energy, the vibe, you know, everybody shows up and nobody's a loser, nobody's a winner. But guess what? Now we're starting to talk points. We're starting talking about egos. You know, this is new territory. You know, the great white north. And now this is going to be a fun one, man. I mean, I'll tell you what, I really think that when they're going to get out of the cars after this battle and hug each other. You know, if it's not, you know, insane, you know, if it's not malicious, I think these guys are going to have a great laugh after this race. So look at Andreas Backerud. He takes that high line. Who had advantage here in this situation? It would be Backerud?
Let me check the.
It's Backerud. Backerud. He was just slightly faster than Frazier McConnell. So he had priority. So Andreas, hence why he chose that.
No, I think it's Frazier. Yeah, Frazier was P2, Backerud was P5. So Frazier had the advantage, gone with the low line.
30 seconds ago, here are our bracket battles. That is right, Group E, all electric, making history. Who's going to be the TQ, the top qualifier? Here at Trois-Rivières, Andreas Backerud going for his first ever TQ spot. DRR, JC, RS Cartel, Monster Energy going against Jamaica Zone. Frazier McConnell piloting that A-Shock vehicle. Again, another DRR vehicle. 13 versus 35. Two laps. Let's see what they got. Two laps for the finals. And here we go. Who's going to get TQ? We saw the perfect event for Frazier McConnell. Can Andreas Backerud get his first ever TQ? NITRO, let's go. Let's set it. Let's see who's going to get the traction. Who's going to get the whole shot? Andreas Backerud spins it. Frazier McConnell looks like he's spinning as well. Frazier McConnell comes out on top. Looks like he's got a car link. You see the wheel working of Andreas Backerud. The snow is getting a lot softer. And Frazier McConnell, man, he is the guy to. Oh, he gets out of shape. And look at that. Frazier McConnell keeps it steady. And Andreas Backerud trying to chase him down.
Backerud's front wheels, you can see, were wandering all over the road. Jared off the line. He bounced off the ruts, sort of left and right as he went, picked up some wheels. He then didn't take that high line that we saw Larson take. He tucks it in tight here as the rear end of Frazier's car kicks up in front of him. At the minute, it's advantage Frazier McConnell, but he's right there. Backerud's right there. He would look at the snow coming up through the air intake on the front. Yeah.
Do you see that? It looked like Andreas Backerud got blinded. He almost missed the Yokohama Tire Joker lap, and that would have been detrimental for him to even have a chance to get past Frazier McConnell.
He was right there, and that's where he needed to be. You've got to be on the tailgate of the car in front. You have to be, because the difference is going to be 2-3 tenths in terms of the perfect lap or not. So if you're not right on the tail of the car in front, it's not going to happen. He was there, but then you saw his air intake on the front suck that snow up and spit it out all over the screen, and has that cost him 3.8. We know the Delta's 3.2.
The attitude of Frazier McConnell's vehicle, he looks like a skeeter bug, just one that's just barely dancing across the surface. The attitude of the car just looks a lot quicker than everybody else, man. I'm just telling you. And you know, Andreas Backrud, he's getting the snow thrown in his face. He's getting exactly what he did to Robin Larson. And I'm telling you, Fraser McConnell, I would not call this beginner's luck, but maybe sophomore luck, or not, no luck at all. He's just driving like he's on dirt. He's driving like a veteran. He is the guy to beat here this weekend. I'm just going to call it.
4.9 seconds, Jared. He's absolutely smashed it. Comes out clearly in front of Andreas Backrud. This is a guy from a very warm island who had never driven on snow and ice until last week up in Finland. He's gone off. He's done a couple of days training. He's come back. I've got to be honest, I'm a big fan of Fraz. He's a good lad. He's a great mate. We know he's a talented driver. He was not my pick for a snow and ice event the first time. Absolutely killing it.
And that's exactly what we're talking about. You know, cool runnings. You know, coincidentally has the egg. That's a storyline. If you've never seen the movie, watch it. I mean, you know, Katie touched on that. And here we go. Fraser McConnell gets a checkered flag, and he's here. TQ here at Trois-Rivieres, making history. Round 7, Nitro Rallycross. You can see the smile, the squinting of his eyes. The A-Shock Energy pilot gets the victory. Let's hear what they have to say.
You made it, hermano. I'm proud of you. Orgulloso de ti, tío.
Keep it up for tomorrow. I feel good for this one, too. Thank you, guys.
Super chill.
Just
keep
super
it
chill.
Up for tomorrow.
Double fist pump.
Amazing.
Yeah, you can hear the Jamaican accent. Might very well be his pops talking to him, getting in his head. Second TQ of the year. He's getting that TQ sticker. He's going to hold up the belt. And keep in mind, when he got TQ last time, he got the victory. That's, like I said, the guy to the beat, the guy to beat the A-Shock Energy vehicle. Really well done. Hey, hats off to Andreas Backrud too. I mean, here he is going for his first ever TQ. It just escapes him. But he, I mean, don't count anybody out. And that's what really comes down to it. With Group E, Nitro Rallycross, what's going on? That's what I really love about it being a spec class as opposed to even last year and, you know, the supercars. I really love this being a spec class. But they are weapons, man.
Travis saying earlier on, wasn't he? He's going, look, we're one of the fastest cars out there. I know I can win this. But then also, going out early in qualifying, it is so close between these drivers that you say anything can happen. I have to say, that is a fantastic performance by Fraser McConnell to take his second TQ of the year on a surface say he's never driven on until last week.
Let's take a look back at where it went right or where it went wrong. Both cars getting a little squirrely, but it looks like the traction of Fraser McConnell's car, that's where he left and was off to the races.
You know what, drivers, Jared, I always find it interesting, even if you were to find that the high line was the quicker one, drivers will nearly always, if you're on pole and you have that choice, they'll nearly always choose the inside line because in their head they'll win the run to turn one. Now Fraser got it done. And actually, we saw, of course, earlier on tonight, Andreas Backrud do it from the outside line. So he knew there was a risk up into turn one. Backrud didn't go for that slightly higher line that we saw last do on the run into the first corner. I thought he might, but he didn't. And to be fair, Fraser sort of gapped him through the course of the run.
The quick two laps, I think, really also cuts down on, you know, figure you have two laps, you can't make any mistakes.
None.
If it's four laps, maybe you have an opportunity. Maybe the other driver messes up. With it just being so concentrated, everything, the finite detail, you're not splitting hairs, you're splitting, you know, you're splitting batteries, you're splitting electricity, baby. The dance is on. This man has danced his way to the TQ spot. Congratulations to Fraser McConnell.
Great job. Just a great. Earlier on, I loved it. I'm not sure you were in the room, but he was there with the helmet. He's going to Kate. He's going, yeah, I've got the egg on the crash. Do you want to kiss the egg? She's like, what? And she's like, you want to kiss the egg? He's like, I don't know. Maybe she's not a cool running fan. Kate, how dare you?
Yeah,
egg. Egg on the back. Sunker, you're dead, man. Yeah, just, you got to go. Yeah, man. You got to go and see that film.
Yeah. Speaking of Katie.
Yeah.
And she didn't kiss the egg. Maybe she'll kiss the egg now or don't, because that might be bad luck. Good luck. We'll see. Katie, what do you think? You going to kiss the egg now?
A little bit different here, wiping off all that snow and ice here from this car from your time in LA when you got your first top qualifier. Congratulations, Fraser McConnell, an epic win there from start to finish. You got the job done. We talked a little bit about your focus. We talked a little bit about the statement you might be making. How would you describe this win for you?
I'm just going out there to have fun. And, you know, Nitro Rallycross has been doing that from the very start. You know, incredible tracks, insane driving, and now people get to watch 1,000 horsepower electric cars go flat out around an ice track. So, you know, I'm enjoying it. And, you know, obviously have to do my condolences to Ken's family. You know, we all have rocking the KB forever on the cars. And, you know, he was a true role model for me growing up. And, you know, I'm going to put his sticker on for him now.
As you slap that sticker on for Ken Block, which go ahead and let's celebrate Ken and this top qualifier finish for you, Fraser McConnell, as we make sure it's perfectly on there and does not roll off due to that water that's on that window. Hey, you know, as it relates to kind of, you know, your mojo and the fun that you're having and the representation for yourself and for your country, this did not come easy because you only started out on snow and ice a week ago in Finland. Catch us up. What's the real story?
No, you know, we always knew that we were going to be coming to ice and snow when we started the year. And did have plans to do some practice before, but we didn't actually do it until last week. Actually flew straight from Finland to here. But, you know, thankfully I did get to do it, but it's a completely different experience with these Yokohama tires. I mean, it's 325 studs. You know, they're three times the width that I was normally driving on. And it's a whole new ball game for all the drivers here, you know, including some ex-rally drivers who had done so many kilometers on any surface you can name. So, you know, happy with this one, and been trusting my instincts all day, and we're going to carry this into tomorrow.
Continue to trust it. Kissing an egg, doing a belt dance. The time has come. You, where's that belt? Where's that belt? And there it is for Fraser.
All right, there it is, the TQ belt, and he fought, you know, it's like a boxing, right? So let's take a look at the, you know, the other awards, and this is the My Energy Best Pass. My Energy, a great sponsor of Nitro Rallycross, providing some energy here, and it's Robin Larson. Robin Larson gets the My Energy Best Pass. Would you agree with this call?
Hey, that's a tight old gap. Just take a big old car through and he did it. So, yeah, why not? Yeah. Look at this from the top. Remember early on that Ollie Ericsson ended up running right up the bank on the inside line. He just about makes it stick on Bennett through there. A little bit of contact between them, but it's door to door. The car's facing the same direction. So, yeah, I think that's a good move.
And next up is the A-Shock Big Air moment. And guess what? Let's give it to that KB43, the KB Forever. Goes to Travis Pastrana. That is the A-Shock Big Air moment. The livery, what do you got?
Wall ride. You know, it was Big Air into a wall ride, yeah, charge. You know, yeah. Look, we know there's not so much Big Air here. He had the left lock on. He ran it up the wall. He risked it for the biscuit. Okay, yeah, he got sucked into a bank half a lap later. It doesn't matter. At least he's won something. It's the A-Shock Big Energy Award.
All right. So, again, just some great accolades there from TQ, My Energy, and A-Shock. And we got some awards being given out. And there you are, Group E qualifying order. Fraser McConnell gets that number one spot. Backward, Larson, Ericsson, Bennett, Ericsson, Pastrana, and Meek. That's how the qualifying ended here at Trois-Rivieres.